Go ahead.
What?
Quiet the room down.
How's everybody doing?
We good?
Can you guys hear us in the back? Because they gave us this stupid wand microphone that we're not going to sit here and pass back and forth. So we'll try to talk real loud so you guys can hear us. So my name's Jason Sayen. I'm with JL Audio. A lot of you guys know me. For those of you that don't, I've been at JL Audio about 10 years. Started out doing tech support and training and been a regional sales manager for the past 7 to 8 years. This training started was about 8 years ago. Manville Smith put it together, and it's usually an eight-hour class. We're condensing a lot of it to do 2 hours today, 2 hours tomorrow morning. So hoping that most of you guys are able to come back in the morning to see part two. It's a really great class. A lot of you guys I know have been doing this a long time. We are going to cover some basic stuff. We're going to make some assumptions that a lot of you guys know some things just because we don't have the time to go into it. But we're going to apply this to what you guys do on an everyday basis. And every time we've done this training, we've had guys that have been doing it 20 or 30 years and go, wow, I never really knew that's how Ohm's Law worked. And they always pick up something. So guarantee you, you're going to learn something cool out of this. We're going to spend time about electronics today, Ohm's Law, AC, DC theory. We're going to start to talk a little bit about music and sound. And tomorrow we're going to get into loudspeaker power handling, and then we're going to talk a lot about music and the effect of music on a system, and then wrap it up with designing some systems based on what we learned. The whole theory of the class is for you guys to design profitable, quality systems for your customers. And a lot of you guys have been doing it a long time. Some of you guys maybe just came on board in the last 5 or so years, and our thought is that when the industry took off, education took a back seat. There's a lot of guys that learned principles and ideas from the guy in the shop that knew the most. But a lot of times, they're not exactly accurate. So there's myths like distortion blows speakers, or when you double power, you get twice as loud. And that's really not accurate. And it's bad to design systems with those principles. Even designing a system matching woofer power ratings and speaker or amplifier power ratings isn't exactly good. And that's what we're going to dissect in this so you guys can, again, design profitable, loud systems. Get the customer what they wanted. So that's kind of an overview of what we're going to talk about. If we are touching on something and you're not understanding it, please ask question, raise your hand. We're condensing it, but we also don't want to leave anyone behind. Does everybody have a booklet? You need one? All right. This is Mike West, by the way. Some of you guys may have talked to him. He's from our tech support team. You can call Mike to help get box design, stealth box instructions, things like that. This book goes into way more detail that we're going to spend, but you can follow along, and we also have a PowerPoint to support it as well. And this is Steve Turrisi.
Hi there. How's everyone doing today? It's a late afternoon one. Hopefully everyone's with us. Right? Yes? No? Everyone's sleeping?
We were going to serve beer, but they wouldn't let us. So.
No outside food or drink. So. My background is very similar to Jason's, I think. I'm technically in charge of the training program at JL Audio. I work really closely with Manville, who put this one together for us. I've been at JL Audio for ever. I think officially it's 15 years. I've been working in the mobile audio industry for about 21 years now, so I'm old, I admit it. But I've been lucky enough to work with some really good people that have taught me a lot. It's my pleasure to be able to share some of that information back. And I don't think I've ever done a presentation where I haven't learned from the audience, which brings me to the most important part of this entire presentation. It's your training. We're just the guys doing it. So if you don't participate, it's going to suck and it's your fault. Fair enough? Now, if it's great, we'll take full credit, of course. But really, it's real important that you participate and get involved in it, because otherwise you're just sitting there listening to us talk. And as wonderful as we think we are, that's not going to be real good for you. So we have your agreement that you're going to participate, right?
And Steve tells really bad jokes, so.
My jokes are fantastic. Everybody laughs or groans or something. Oh, I see. I have some followers here. All right. So, yeah, where are we at?
So we're going to start this with throwing up a couple of systems that Steve and I put together based on how a lot of people...
What's that? Do those...
Yeah, that's fine.
What they want?
Based on how a lot of us design systems. Before we show that, though, we want to talk about a couple of things. What are customers looking for when they come to your shop?
What do they ask for?
Better sound.
They ask for bass. Better sound. What does that really mean? Like, ultimately, what does that boil down to? Because better sound and bass sometimes are quite a conflict, I think, no? So what are they really asking for? Your opinion. Ooh, I like
Freddie.
That one.
The best lines you have.
Well, we all know the answer to that unbiased question, right? I think ultimately what they're asking for, and all of you have really touched on it, is they want some kind of performance. Some people call it bass, some people call it sound quality. Whatever performance is, that's really what they're looking for. Fair enough? So let's go ahead and check this out. So customers are looking for performance that meets or exceeds their expectations. And they're very rarely going to tell you what those expectations are. That's where you've got to kind of figure some things out. Beyond that, I think they're also looking for reliability. But very rarely will you have a customer come in and say, hi, I'm looking for reliability. Do you have that? It's just not the way it works out. But it's implied that they don't want their system to fail or break or cause any problems with their vehicle. And like Jason was saying before, a lot of what we're going to talk about is going to touch on that. Next is confidence that they bought the right product from the right people. Because there's a lot of people selling car audio stuff out there. Some of them do it right, some of them don't. And when a customer comes into our shop, it's our job to make sure that they feel comfortable and confident buying from us. Next one is good service, which I think is also implied. They don't come in and ask if they're going to get good service or not. That, again, is up to our salespeople and installers to make them feel comfortable that they're getting the right product. And if something goes wrong, that you take care of it in a quick and timely manner without, you know, a lot of fighting or anything like that. And the last one there is value for their money, which is really the first four of them all combined. And if you think about it in terms of performance, if they're paying you for the system and it meets all of these objectives, they probably feel that whatever they spent was worth it. So that's what customers are looking for. What do you want? Who said that? Profitability. There's nothing wrong with that. So long as you've done this, profitability is something that you have a right to earn. But you have to earn it. And I think if you do this, you get that. What's the other thing we're looking for beyond just profitability? Business growth. Absolutely. So if you look at the next slide, you guys already jumped ahead, I guess. Profitability and business growth. The only way you're going to get that long term is if we go back one slide and you give your customers that. So that's what we want to talk about today. That's the setup for what we're going to talk about next was the system designs, right?
Yep.
So we, Jason and I on a plane ride recently, we're talking about a couple of system ideas. And the first one we came up with, you got that sheet over there?
Yes.
We came up with a system, have to be a bit biased. We know JL products better than we know other people's products, so we're going to use that. Substitute any equivalent price point or concept product wherever you need to. But the system we came up with was a 12W7. Running off the HD1200/1. Who's laughing?
We'll ship at the end of this.
We will be shipping that, really. We mean it this time. We set up two pairs of the C3 650s, one for up front, one for in the back. Those are going to run off an XD400/4. It's a 400-watt four-channel amplifier. And we use the power kit because you need wires to connect all this stuff, right? So we use a 2-amp, 2-gauge power kit. You want to put prices on that?
Sure.
So the 12W7 sells for about $850. The HD1200, when you can actually sell it, will sell for about $995. Sorry, $999. My mistake there, Jay. Just erase that. Each set of the C3s are $400 for each pair. The XD400/4 sells for about $400. You guys got comparable product like that, 400-watt, $400 amplifier, something like that, 4-channel. And then the last thing, the power kit was $250, Jay. Total system price, if anyone's really good at math, I'll save you the trouble, it's $3,300. Wouldn't it be great to have that system come in every day?
Yes.
It would be really nice, I think. How's that system going to perform? Pretty good? Nothing really crazy wrong with it, right?
For argument's sake, we left out the cost of labor and everything to install it because that's a fixed cost. It's pretty much going to be the same. So what we want to just look at is the breakdown of the product. You know, aside from the price, it's probably not an everyday system, but someone comes in, they want one big powerful woofer like a W7. They want as much power as possible. A lot of times they drop back to go with maybe a lesser amplifier to save on some money. But overall, we got, you know, good quality components, nice subwoofer, lots of power, nice sale.
Not bad.
Everyone agree? Okay.
But like we've been saying, it's not every day you get a $3,000-plus system walking in your store. So we actually came up with another system. This one's a bit more reasonable. This one would be nice, too. We came up with a 13W3, which is 13.5, or big subwoofer. That sells for $320, if you want to put that right up. The JX1000, 1,000-watt monoblock amplifier to drive the 13, and that sells for $450. And we had a 4-channel amp, the JX360/4. It's 360-watt 4-channel amplifier. Sells for, what is that, $250? Front and rear speakers, C2650s up front and in the rear. These are 6.5-inch component systems. And they each sell for $250, Jay. A little less power on this one. We can use a 4-gauge 2-amp kit. And that one sells for $150. Who's good with the math? No one? $1670 is your retail price, Jay. Also a very nice system, I think. Maybe a little bit more reasonable for a typical customer that's interested in car audio. You agree? What do you think about the overall performance capability of a system like that? Nice big woofer, lots of power driving it, four-channel amplifier, speakers front and rear. Should do the job, I think. Pretty good, huh? And at $1,670, I think that's fairly reasonable once you add in labor and all that other thing. I would be thrilled if I had customers coming in asking for something like that all day long. What do you think, Jay?
All right. We'll revisit these at the end of the day tomorrow to apply everything we learned to see if these are really good systems or not such good systems. But overall, I would think they're pretty good systems, something that some of you may have even sold at some point in time. All right, we're going to talk a little bit about electrical basics. We're going to talk about Ohm's law. We're not going to go into as much detail and, again, make some kind of assumptions. How many people have used Ohm's law before? All right, good.
Where have you used it? What have you done with it? A lot of hands. Come on, so you should give me one. It does pretty much applies to everything you do. But a lot of people that don't use it every day, the ones that didn't raise their hands perhaps, may not realize how powerful it actually can be. And one thing you got to remember, this is not Ohm's best guess or Ohm's prediction. It's Ohm's law. It's proven. This is something that's unchallenged anywhere. This works. So when you use it every day for everything you do, it's actually something that's provable, repeatable, testable over and over. It makes you look good. Remember the first five things we talked about? Confidence to buy from people that know what they're talking about. If you can use Ohm's law, what you deal with customers, and we'll show you how, it makes you look really good.
And a lot of times we assume that, well, this is the installer's job to know Ohm's law. They're the one that are using the tools and doing all the installations. But as salesmen, you should know Ohm's law as well. You can help conquer sales with the customer. The customer comes in and is dead set on the 1,000-watt amp, and you're trying to explain why it may not be a good amplifier for his Honda Civic with a 50-amp alternator. Instead of just telling him, no, it's a bad choice, you can actually do some math and show him why. And as Steve says, it's Ohm's law. It's not Ohm's, I don't think so. And not many other shops are doing that. They're either going to, A, sell the guy the 1,000-watt amp because he asked for it, even knowing that it's going to come back and you're going to have headaches over time, or B, they're going to tell the kid no and upset him because they're not giving him a good answer. So as a salesperson, you can use this every day as well. So we're just going to do two examples of Ohm's law, and we have this slide up here which kind of gives you an example of how voltage current relationships all work. The voltage is your potential, current is the flow of the electricity, and resistance is a byproduct of such, which allows current to flow through the system.
How many have seen something like that before? A little analogy there, kind of makes sense. And if you look at it, the pressure on the water pushing down to flow through the resistive pipe, and as the water flows out, that's current. So if we had a bigger diameter pipe, would the resistance go up or down? Resistance will go down because the water can flow easier, less resistance, it can flow easier. So it's a nice little analogy, it makes a little bit of sense. But Jason's going to touch on Ohm's law. And have you ever heard of the Ohm's law circle, the little chart that you see up there? This thing's really neat. And when we were working on this thing, it was like, you got to cover it with your thumb. So we went ahead and drew in a thumb. Pretty creative of us, isn't it? But what this is basically showing with the three main parts of electricity that we're going to look at, if you know two of them, you can figure out the third one without a problem. So, Jay, we had a couple of examples we want to use?
Yeah, where are those examples?
I don't know. I got them right here.
We're going to randomly pull some numbers.
Completely at random. We haven't thought about this before. So what are you going to figure first? So Jason's put a voltage on the screen, on the board over there, and a resistance. So basically, if you look in the middle one there, we know the voltage, which is E, and the resistance, which is R. He's got 54.8 volts and 4 ohms. Who's got a calculator? Which everybody in the room probably does because you've got a phone with a calculator on it, so no excuses. Who wants to do the math for me? Bueller? Bueller? Anyone? Anyone? Jay, you want to do the math for him?
13.7 amps.
13.7 what?
Amps.
Amps. That's how we measure current, of course. So I, in this case, will work out to be 13.7.
All right, let's do one more example.
Everyone get that? See where that came from? You said you're using it every day. You seen that before? All right, so there you go. I'm going to pick on you. You spoke up. Remember, it's your training. So what do you got now, Jay?
So we have a current of 12.3 amps and a resistance of 2.
So that one would be the bottom one on the left over there. We have I and R. We need E. Figure out the voltage. What was that?
24.7.
Is he right with those numbers we picked at random?
Yes.
Okay. So you said you've seen this before. Where have you seen something like this before?
On the wall of my shop.
On the wall of your shop. I want to visit your shop. That's cool to have that on the wall of your shop. There's a thing that we've done many, many years ago. We came up with an easy way of setting levels on an amplifier, and it makes some assumptions on various different things, but what we came to the conclusion of using Ohm's law, and actually if I go ahead one slide, we can actually expand this into calculating power as well. By using Ohm's law, you can actually determine the power capability of an amplifier. Big assumptions being made, okay, and I'll tell you exactly how this works. First assumption that we're going to go to is that your source unit, be it a factory source unit or an aftermarket source unit, whatever it may be, does not clip at 3/4 volume position. And most of the time, this is a safe assumption to make. Can we agree that that's an okay assumption? Okay. The second assumption that we're going to make is that everyone needs to clip an amplifier, but they don't know when. Fair enough? And the other thing that we need to look at is, Jason said earlier, we're going to make a couple of guesses about where you are with your level of understanding and comprehension of what we're going to share. You probably know that there's a difference between impedance and resistance, where resistance is a DC phenomenon, where impedance is an AC phenomenon. So we're just going to say that if it's a 4-ohm speaker, it's a 4-ohm resistor. And if we know these things by using this as well as the Ohm's law circle from before, we can actually set the level on your amplifier without using anything fancier than this. How many of us have an O-scope in the shop?
Wow.
That's probably the highest percentage that we've ever seen in one of these presentations, and that's fantastic.
How many use it?
Okay. That's also a very high percentage. I'm very impressed by that. An O-scope is definitely the best way to set levels on an amplifier, because with it you can determine when the head unit really clips without making the assumption that we made before. Also with it you can determine when the amplifier is going to clip by measuring the outputs. For those that don't know, an oscilloscope is something that allows you to see what music is doing or see what a sine wave is doing. Why do we use sine waves so much? When we do testing and setup and stuff like that, why do we use sine waves? When we listen to music, why sine waves? It's consistent, because what a sine wave does is it never changes. It's always the same thing over and over. So if anything about that sine wave is different, it's a distortion. And we want to look for that and find out changes. So with an O-scope, we can see when things start running into trouble or start distorting. So using an O-scope is definitely the best, but not everybody raised their hand. So knowing that not everybody raised their hand, we have to assume that most people are not going to have an O-scope to set levels right. So if you go to the, what page is it on here, Jay?
Towards the back.
Now the handout is actually specific for JL Audio amplifiers, but it really can be applied to just about any amp. If you go to page 41 in your handout.
42.
41 is the procedure.
Oh.
41 is the procedure, 42 is some voltages that we've calculated out for you. Basically, this takes advantage of the E squared divided by R for power. We rework that, and what we can come up with is what voltage for a given amount of power at a given load that your amplifier can produce. And the way it works is simple. I'll go through the procedure. You take your volume position on your head unit with the amplifier connected but no speakers plugged in. This is a big one. Disconnect the speakers, take the volume position on your source unit, turn it up to 3/4 position. You put in a disc like something with test tones that are, you know what I mean, when I say not attenuated, there's not like a minus 10 dB or anything like that. Full on sine wave at, let's say, 50 hertz for a bass amplifier and maybe 1,000 hertz for a mid-range and high frequency amp. A tone that's appropriate for the speakers you're going to hook up. So we'll start with a bass amp. So we put a 50 hertz bass sine wave in there. And we take the volume, we put a 3/4 position. Then we take our voltmeter and we put it on the outputs of the amplifier. And then we take the input sensitivity and we start raising the input sensitivity until the voltmeter is reading whatever the voltage needs to be. So if you look at page 42, let's pick an amp. What amp do you want to use, Jay?
Well, let's do the ones we calculated.
Okay. Which one
so
is that?
Take voltage squared divided by resistance, 54.8 times 54.8 divided by 4 is 750 watts.
So if you were to follow this procedure and look for a voltage of 54.8 on the output, that would be the same as having 750 watts into a 4-ohm resistor, which again we're assuming is very close to what a 4-ohm nominal impedance would be. Real simple to do. It only takes a few minutes, and I always kid around that even a salesman like me could do it. You know, you don't need to be a high-level installer to pull out a voltmeter and get a voltage on the output. Some things that you need to know. If you have a source unit that says that it's a high voltage output, I don't care. I don't care what that voltage is because I'm not measuring the output of that. I'm measuring how that's coupling with the amplifier. What I mean by that is some amplifiers will have a range switch, low voltage or high voltage. Always start in the low voltage. If it's too much, you switch it over to high voltage and it works out just fine. ultimately, at the end of the day, when you get the voltage that you're looking for the power of that particular amplifier, your amp is set. And how is it set? If you really think about it, how is it set? With all the assumptions that we made, this amplifier at 3/4 volume position, when music is recorded at its highest level, like it would be with a sine wave, is also going to make the amplifier produce 750 watts or full power in this case. So what happens if our customer goes beyond 3/4 volume position? The amp is going to clip, and this is fine. What we're trying to prevent is the ridiculous phenomenon that I know everyone in this room has seen. When a customer sets their own levels on the amplifier, they set it so when they turn it 1/4 position, everything is maxed out, clipping like crazy, and it sounds horrible. And I actually had a customer play his system for me in this setup, and at the end of a blistering minute and a half of this ridiculous music, he turned it down. He said, "What do you think?" I said, "Wow, that was loud." He says, "That's at 1/4. Imagine if I turned it up." And that's when it hit me. It's loud because it's so loud at low volume. Imagine if I only could turn it up louder, it would get even more power. No, it doesn't. You start running out of power. So the idea of this level setting that we just went through is to put everything more towards the end of the volume position so we can control the clipping, so the customer doesn't get into trouble. And what I like about it is, and I think everyone in this room has probably had a situation where customer buys a system from us, we set everything up, maybe using an O-scope, maybe using a system similar to this, and the customer leaves and everything sounds great. A couple of days goes by, customer comes back in with blown speakers. You go in there and you know darn well that that's not where you set the levels on the amplifier. So what do you say to your customer? "You screwed with it, no warranty, you're out of here." Remember point number 3 or 4 it was before? Confidence that they're buying the right stuff from the right people, quality of service. By yelling at our customers is not a good thing, but by demonstrating something repeatable and explaining them why it's important, such as, "Look, it looks like you made a change on that input sensitivity, because when I put my voltmeter on it, I was reading 80 volts. Oh yeah, a buddy of mine told me that if I turn that up, I can get more power." Your buddy doesn't do this as often as we do, and what we know is that amplifiers have limits, and we've set it so that that limit is near the limit of your volume control. "Look, if you need more output, that's something we can do, but if you change the settings on the system, I'm not going to be able to warranty this for you again." It's repeatable. You can demonstrate it for your customer and give them confidence that they are dealing with someone who actually knows what they're talking about, not someone that says, "Ah, you mess with it. Get out of here." So you see how that can help out? Another kind of way of using Ohm's law. I went off a little bit.
Repeatedly swapping out woofers every
other week. Really bad and certainly not going to help us with that business growth or profitability aspect, right?
Let's calculate the other one. We do, again, voltage squared divided by resistance. So 24.6. times 24.6 divided by 2. Anyone do it? 300 watts. So again, as a salesperson, this is something you can do. The customer comes in, "Hey, I want to buy a woofer. I already got this amplifier. It's the 1,000 watt incriminator I bought at the flea market." You can go out there with your test tone and your CD and measure it and actually see what kind of power it does. And instead of telling him how much of a piece of crap it is and offending him, it's what he bought. You can actually do Ohm's law and show them, "Look, dude, this really only does 300 watts. Do the math. Guy will be blown away, and no one else is going to do that for him." So, again, another way you can use it on a daily basis.
You got one more you want to do?
Yeah, let's do one more example. Anybody got any questions on where the math's coming from? Remember back in high school, when am I going to use this shit? You do? Yeah. So let's say we have a voltage source of 110. We have an impedance of 4 ohms. Let's calculate our current.
I'll cheat. I'll put the other slide up again. Whoops.
I don't think your slide's popping up, by the way.
That would be bad.
So 110 divided by 4 is 27.5 amps. Anyone know the power?
Three thousand watts.
Pretty cool.
Watts.
Where have we seen 110 volts? Anybody ever plug a woofer into a wall outlet?
No, never.
Anybody ever know how much power it is? Anybody know why some people can plug woofers into walls and not blow them? Does the woofer really handle 3,000 watts? Unfortunately, there's some manufacturers that do this magic trick in training, but they're not telling you the whole story. So what, does anyone know what the carrier frequency is, the wall outlet is?
60 hertz.
60 hertz. And as Steve was saying, impedance changes on a speaker. A lot of times at 60 hertz, speaker's impedance can be 80 ohms or higher. So the amount of power that's really going to the speaker is about 200 watts. So in that case, you can plug the woofer into the wall. It's really not getting 3,000 watts. You can do the math where it's kind of showing you that, but it's not really the case. But it can produce that much power. Now, real quick, if I drop this impedance to 2, what's this going to change to? 6,000. How'd you know that? Some people just know it because they know when you cut impedance, power doubles, but they don't really know the math. So if you do the math, 110 divided, multiplied by 2 divided by 2, it goes to 6,000. That's the relationship between voltage, current, resistance. That's why it's Ohm's law. If that doesn't happen, something is wrong. And that's where you can use it to prove people indifferent, because it's Ohm's law. The math has to work. We were working out one of these problems earlier that we do for an example, and the numbers weren't coming out right. And I'm like, something's wrong. And of course, I was multiplying something incorrectly. But that's the thing with Ohm's law. If this is the end result, you know it's going to be there. Did you figure it out?
I'm working on it, Jay.
Any questions on this? Anybody ever seen that magic wall trick? Some guys in chops will build a porter box tuned to 60 hertz and then hook it up to the light switch, and you can just wow people. Pretty neat.
We've got it to shred subs.
Yeah. When I was in retail, you need to send it back for warranty, make sure it's blown. Absolutely.
No comment on that one.
So there's some talk about series parallel wiring in there, and we're not going to get into details. Most of you guys have done series parallel wiring. But we're going to do an example of applying Ohm's law to a circuit. So if we look at this circuit, and I'm a horrible artist, so I already know that. So if we have a circuit, we have 2 4-ohm resistors. How are these wired? Series or parallel?
Series.
Yeah, they're series. And we have this 8-ohm resistor, and then how are these two actually wired?
Parallel.
In parallel. So anybody know our total impedance? Yeah, it's 4. Basically, these two in series is 8. 8 and 8 in parallel is 4, so your total resistance is 4. Let's say we had a circuit. We had our total voltage of 44.7 volts. We'll figure out our total current, which is just these two divided by each other. And I already did the math. It's 11.275. Now, have you ever had a customer come in and said, hey, I got 3 woofers, I got 2 4-ohms and an 8-ohm, I want to put them in this box? Will that work? Because, you know, it's a 4-ohm load, it's perfect for my amplifier. Why do they not want to do that?
They're going to be getting different amounts of power.
Yeah, there's lots of reasons why. One, if you don't divide up the box, it's bad. Two, they're going to be getting different amounts of power. But here, now you can use Ohm's law and actually show them why. So basically you have 44.7, and if you do the math, 44.7 to figure out power. You got 500 watts. Now, in theory, 500 is going to divide, and you'll have 250, 250, and then 125, 125. But you can actually do the math. Current splits up, so you have 5 amps, because in a parallel circuit, current divides. So our total current's 11 and a quarter. So it's going to divide to 5.5 and 5.5. And then you can use one of those power formulas to actually do the math. Steve doesn't have our power formula. But
hang on. I got it working finally.
But it ends up being 250 watts, 125, and 125. So we know that just because we know how things are going to divide up, but a lot of times it's hard to explain that to a customer. You can actually do the math with Ohm's law and show them why that's not a good idea. Or, hey, I got an old dual voice coil W3. I can buy an 8-ohm W3 single voice coil and wire them up. You know, in theory, with the impedance matched, it's fine, but it's really not a good thing to do. You have different power to each coil. And just overall, it's not a good solution.
There.
Ah, there it is.
The wire came out of my computer.
Yeah, you can do the 5.5 times 5.5 times 4, and then you'll get the 125 watt. Any questions on a series parallel circuit?
Good. Everybody still awake?
I'm going to do one more example. And I'm running out of ink.
We only have the one pen, too, so.
Yeah.
Make it last, Jay.
I'll try. We'll have to resort to shadow puppets.
Man came prepared.
All right. Those in back can't see because my Sharpie ran out. So I have 6 resistors. They're each 6 ohms. They're wired in series or parallel?
Series,
and then in parallel. What's the total impedance? Well, we do 12, because 6 and 6 is 12. There's a shortcut one where basically you do the value, the resistance divided by the number. So you have 12, and then it's 3, so it's 4 ohm load. Where have we seen this before?
Old W6s.
Old W6s. Why do we do that? Anyone know why? Were we just trying to be weird and different with three woofers?
I think so.
Because you wanted to get Mo to go crazy in the Bible.
You remember Mo now, do you?
What did you say?
I said you wanted to get Mo to go crazy in the Bible.
I wanted to get Mo to go crazy in the Bible. What Joey said is one reason we want to be able to fit three woofers between the shock towers, because it's, you know, usually you got about 36 to 38 inches. Two woofers works great. Four woofers is louder, but doesn't necessarily fit. So to get three woofers, you had to have a way to manipulate the outputs of the amplifier. Most amplifiers back then, Class AB's 4 ohm was a good load to get full power out of it. What's the other way that you could do the impedance? You could wire it to a 1 ohm load. Who remembers what types of amps we had back then that would run off a 1 ohm load?
Remember the old cheater amps?
Yeah, all the
funny to see the camps, the Orion camp, the PPI camp, the Rockford camp. It's awesome. But there's high current amplifiers and high voltage amplifiers. And like Jason mentioned, the most common AB amplifiers of the day were either going to be 4 ohms, which would be a high voltage amplifier, or the cheater amplifiers, the Orions, the Rockfords, the PPI ones, which were high current. And what these amplifiers did, for those that don't remember, is as you lowered the impedance load on the output of the amplifier, it would actually produce more power than its 4 ohm rating. So it might say it's 100 watts, but it was like 10 million watts into a half ohm load or something crazy like that. But the most common ones were either 4 ohms or 1 ohm. So what we had done back then was a way for retailers to be able to sell three woofers that fit with an impedance load that made sense with the amplifiers that a customer was likely to buy. Worked out pretty good, I think, no? Anyone that sold it probably found that it actually worked really, really well. And, you know, fortunately for us, we were able to do quite a bit with it. And, well, that's another story for after five.
What's interesting is the shop I worked at in Michigan, I mean, we used to sell loads of triple 10 or triple 12 W6s off of PPIA 600. 200 watts per woofer. Everybody knew that system jammed, but what were W6s rated at?
Anyone remember?
Yeah, they're rated at 300 watts. So here we are running these woofers with less power than what's recommended, but anyone that heard that system would swear by it. Extremely reliable, performed quite well.
Ooh, that just was two about, of the list earlier, if you remember.
Just about at, you know, at no point would we have a customer that would break that stuff. So kind of interesting. Any questions on Ohm's Law? We didn't spend a lot of time. There's a lot of examples in the book, but it's important to understand the relationships between current and voltage and power, like the example with the impedance dropping and the wall outlet and the power doubling, and being able to predict what's going to happen and then use the math to actually figure it out if you're in a situation where you have to talk with a customer. We're going to apply more of it tomorrow towards the end of the day with the system design. But Steve's going to touch base on some AC theory and magnets, which is our kind of his favorite thing.
I like magnets. They're cool. I'm sure everyone's seen an annoying magnet like this. You've seen something like this. Remember high school? No? No one remembers high school? Neither do I. Magnets are actually pretty interesting things, and yes, I get a little excited about them. But pretty much everything we do in our business has something to do with a magnet at some point. I think most of us know that magnets have a north and a south pole, and if you put the north to the north, it wants to push each other away. But the north to the south, it wants to attract each other, and I got a cool little demo on that. I brought this into my kids' school, and they loved it. So I got a magnet here from a speaker, and I got another one identical to it, and I got this set up so I can drop this on here. And a lot of people don't realize that magnetic fields are actually squishy. Sorry about the technical language. But I think you all knew that they were squishy because if they weren't squishy, if I dropped this magnet, it would just stop as soon as the fields came into contact with each other. But when I drop it, it actually bounces and floats, and it's a pretty cool thing, and I keep this in my office when I'm not doing trainings.
Yes, it sits on his desk along with the rest of this stuff.
Yeah, my office is a little empty right now, but yeah. Well, it's fun. So magnets obviously can do stuff without you seeing them. The other thing I have here, Jay, can you hear me that tray? Is a tray of iron filings that can show a magnetic field around a magnet, so you can actually see it's a three-dimensional thing and not just a two-dimensional thing like you see there. So yeah, I like magnets quite a bit. What I think is really cool about magnets is you can make your own magnet just by using a coil of wire. Most people just take it for granted that when you run electricity through a piece of wire, it creates a small magnetic field around that wire. And if you coil it up like you see on the screen, if you coil it up, you can concentrate that magnetic field to create your own little magnet. It's not a permanent magnet like the ones I have here, but it's something that can change. If I run DC through it, it'll establish a field and it'll pretty much sit there. But if I run AC through it, I can do some fun stuff with it. But what I'm going to do here is some DC stuff. And I like this, so get ready. All right, so what I did here, for the people in the back, let me see if I can lift this up. You see this red wire that I got here? Where have you seen this wire before? Crossovers. Whoever said crossovers, excellent answer. Now check this out. This is what's called magnet wire or motor wire. And what magnet wire or motor wire is it's just a wire that's got a thin coating of enamel that protects it. So like if you cross it over on itself, it's not a dead short because there's an enamel coating on it. So you can wind it up real, real, real tight like we're kind of depicting there. Or you can think of other areas you might see a wire like this. So I was walking by one of the guys in tech's office a number of years ago, I guess it was. And in the garbage, I saw a big mound of motor wire. I said, what the hell's that doing in the garbage? One of the crossovers, you know, the plastic that holds the wire in place, it broke and it became unwound. I said, so you throw it away? Never, never throw motor wire away. First of all, it's really expensive. Second of all, you can make cool things like this. So what I did here was I made a simple motor. I have any idea what this thing is? It's a shiny silver disc of magnetic material. It's a big slug of neodymium. You probably know of neodymium. A lot of tweeters use it, but there's a really big piece of it. Borrowed this from a guy at our shop, George. He's into magnets too. So what I got here is I got a power supply. I got wires connected to the power supply, and there's a very fancy prop here. For those that can't easily see it, it's a piece of wood I found in the shop. A couple of bent paper clips with some screws that I had in my office, and I screwed them down, and I made these little hooks to hold this coil of motor wire that I found in the garbage. I'm a bit of a pack rat, if you haven't figured that out already. So what I'm going to do is I have this magnetic field down here, which is much like the bottom one of my little floating display here, and I have a coil of wire that I'm going to energize with the power supply, send DC through it to create a magnetic field like you see on the screen. And hopefully, if it's still working like it was earlier, I'll have a very simple motor. And there it goes. Look at that. Isn't that great? My clearance is off there. So here we go. So if I... Anything to spoil, look at that, that's great, isn't it? Kill it, yeah. Well, the intent is to make a spin around, but this means nothing to you other than the fact that you saw something was going on with the coil, other than getting really, really hot. Check it out.
Wow.
And that wasn't on for very long. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to have a little fun here. Now, this might not work at first because I might have my polarity reversed, but I have a voice coil, which is made of the same type of wire, motor wire or magnet wire, and I got the same magnet that I had over there, but instead of floating of another permanent magnet over it, I'm going to float an electromagnet over it. Now, if I've wired this right, this should jump, and I've wired it wrong. You know about reversing polarity? That's all I got to do here. Go ahead and grab that, and when I energize it, it does basically the same thing that this does. Proof that there's magic in the universe. I made a magnet out of just electricity and a bunch of old wire, which is the principle that we're trying to demonstrate here. Why this is important will become very, very clear as we go forward. How hot is it?
Yeah, it's fairly warm.
It's getting warm. So it's only 12 volts going to it, but there's quite a bit of current because it's only a 4 ohm load. So that's fun. And in this case, it truly is 4 ohm because I am running DC. But in a speaker, obviously, we have alternating current. And with alternating current, it'll rise up, fall down, rise up, fall down. Hey, fall down. And it also reverses. So when it falls down, it'll actually go into a negative sine wave. And we'll talk about that in a minute. So that's how magnets work, and that's why they're important for audio things and other things that we're going to talk about as we go forward today and into tomorrow. Everyone cool with the way magnets work? I've got to be honest with you, I could talk about this a lot longer, but he always yells at me and we're short on time. So, if we ever come to town and do School of Sound full version, you'll learn more about magnets. Okay, So I mentioned AC and how it's different from DC. DC, if you've got a 12-volt battery, let's just say that it's really 12 volts and not the 12.6 that you already know it to be. Let's just say it's 12 volts. It's DC, so it is, period, 12 volts. It doesn't change. But with AC, it does change. It ramps up and falls down. So if you look here, I have two sine waves on the board. The lighter colored one is it says 4 volts on it, and the lower one is 3 volts. And you can see they kind of track. They go up to create a peak voltage, and they drop down to the big line, the black line in the center. That's a zero reference, which really is no voltage at all. Then it goes down, and it creates a negative peak. And I always have trouble with this because I like to think of money. Anything negative with money is a bad thing, but with AC voltage, it's okay. So if I had a 4-volt peak and a minus 4-volt peak, they're still peaks. It's just moving in the opposite direction. Visualize, if you could, if I had this thing set up with an AC waveform and I could suspend the magnet in midair, I can make it so the coil would move up and then move back down and move back up, and only when I turned it off it would center itself. Have you ever seen anything do that before? Anywhere? Anywhere. Speakers. The suspension holds the coil in that center area so that when you apply a positive voltage it moves up, you apply a negative voltage it moves down. Kind of an extrapolation of my little display there.
Weren't you going to show something with
that? I'm going to show it, yes. So this is one of my favorite toys. They call it the abacus back at work.
The W7.
Oh, yeah, we'll show that next. Yeah. Sorry, hold on to that for a second. We got something here. You guys ever see something like this? Anyone know what this is? This is, you can use this to prove that airbags work, right? So if you have one of these in the shop, I'm going to show you a new way to use this that you don't cost yourself a lot of money fixing airbags. So I kind of showed you how you run electricity through a coil of wire, creates a magnetic field. The other side of that is if you run a magnet near a coil of wire, it creates electricity. Isn't it neat? And I'll show you that. So let me go ahead and put this back in here. So I have the little clamp on this on one terminal, and I have the probe going into the other one. And what I'm going to do here, it's going to be hard for the folks in the back, but if I push down on this, I can make that thing light up. I'm making electricity. Look, it's free. Light your home. Impress your friends. Where's the energy coming from? Lunch. You take that energy, you make it into motion, and by moving that coil of wire near the very strong magnetic field, I can make electricity. Not particularly efficient, but it does work. So you can see how the whole thing is reversible. Cool. Now can I show my abacus?
Sure.
Okay, thanks. Move this out of my way. Pull my abacus over here. All right, so this represents a sine wave. If you focus in on the red beads on there, that's a sine wave. We've talked about a sine wave. It's a positive voltage peak and a negative voltage peak. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take another sine wave that has the same frequency and the same amplitude, and I'm going to show you what happens when you combine voltages. So if I take this and I set it up like so, what happened to our red line? It's the same general shape, it's only larger now. So I've taken the two voltages and I've added them. Now at the valleys, are just as high as the peaks were, only now bigger than they were previously. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to screw up. And I'm going to screw up by moving this so that the peaks are now where the valleys used to be. And what did I wind up with? A flat line. Where have you seen that before? Oops. It's basically that. So now if you look at what we have on the screen there, we have a peak voltage of 3 volts on the black line and a peak voltage of 3 volts on the blue line, except they're out of phase. So if I was to take a plus 3 and add a minus 3, what do I get?
Zero.
I get 0. This applies to voltages and it also applies to audio. Have you ever seen that before? Where's the most common place that we've seen something like this? You miswired that subwoofer system, and you got two woofers, and one, you flip the wires, kind of like what I had happen over here. Flip them the wrong way. So what happens is, as one woofer is moving out, the other one's moving in, and the net result is nothing. But have you noticed how it's not really nothing? There's always a little something going on, because you're not just playing a sine wave. If you played a sine wave, you'd probably get pretty damn close to nothing, unless, well, there's some weird things that can make you get some other thing. But if you're listening to music, you'll have other frequencies that will be in or out of phase relative to the other speaker. And to help show that, I have another sine wave. This one is double the frequency, half the amplitude. So now what happens when I put this in here, I can't line up peaks or valleys, because it doesn't always line up. So what you wind up with is a complex waveform of two different frequencies playing at the same time. What's in phase? What's out of phase? It's real, real hard to figure that out. This, my fine friends, is similar to what music might be. It's not just sine waves. It's not that simple. Music is far more complex, and we will talk a lot more about that a little bit later. So some more on sine waves. Everyone cool with that? Everyone get where I'm coming from? It's a pretty cool little toy, though, isn't it? I like it. We were going to build this, but my guys yelled at me, don't build it. You can buy it. So I bought it instead. But I think we would have built it better. Bigger, for sure. Anyway. All right, sine waves. A couple of things you need to know as we go forward. Some key points of a sine wave. We've already talked about peak voltage. And we kind of talked about peak-to-peak voltage, where we have, you know, plus 3 and a minus 3. So that's a peak and another peak. But the effect of RMS is what I want to focus in on. Because unlike DC, that is 12 volts all the time, a 3-volt peak on AC is not 3 volts. As a matter of fact, the only time it would be 3 volts is at the very top of that sine wave. More often than not, it's not at the peak. It becomes an effect of RMS voltage. Now, a lot of times in our industry, we hear peak power versus RMS power. What good is peak power? It's not good at all, because of the time duration that the product is going to be at that peak point. It's ineffective. But why do we use peak power so often? Because the W's on the side of the box get really big, and people like that. But in reality, when we go to apply it, we need to know what the product is really capable of doing. I do need to point out, however, that this is voltage that we're talking about and not power. Who remembers how to figure out power if I know voltage? You need one other thing. Resistance or impedance. We got to fudge that a little bit. So if we have that, we can figure out overall power. Voltage squared divided by resistance, for example. So that's how we get power. This is not power. This is just the voltage. So if you look ahead in the book, you'll learn that power is a squared function of voltage. Voltage squared divided by resistance, squared function. So power is going to be a little bit different than this. So we'll touch on that right now. Voltage, if you know the peak and you want to find the average or the RMS or effective voltage, you multiply the peak by 0.707 voltage. If you know the average and you want to find out the peak for whatever reason, you do 1.41 times that RMS value to get to the peak. And if you want to do the square function, then you take that and square whatever it is to determine the power of the product. Good? Everyone still with me? Fantastic. Want to get into some sounds?
Yeah.
This is, if you haven't figured out already, we're laying groundwork, because if you don't follow some of this stuff, everything we talk about later today and into tomorrow, it's not going to make a whole lot of sense. Because we're going to start talking about sound, finally. Who recognizes that instrument? Come on, people, wake up with me. Yes, it's a piano. Of course it's a piano. You've noticed that I've broken it down, and I've got some numbers across the bottom of the screen there. It goes 20, 40, 80. What are those numbers? Specifically, they're frequencies. But what's special about those frequencies? Who said the O word? They're octaves. What's a good definition of an octave if you just looked at the screen and you had to figure something out? How would you describe that to someone? Exactly. It's a halving or a doubling of frequencies. And it's not just those frequencies. It could be any frequencies. Let's try one. 5,000 hertz, go one octave up. 10,000 hertz. Okay. 160 hertz, go one octave down. 80. Simple enough. Yeah, that's already on there. But you got the point. You figured it out. So why did I use these particular frequencies in these particular octaves? I start at 20 and I go all the way up to 20.8. Let's call it 20,000 hertz. This is what most people consider the range of human hearing. That's a lie, because you can't hear that. And I know that because most of us in this room have been at that show floor, and we've done significant damage to our hearing today, if not in our past. So technically, a newborn baby is alleged to be able to hear from 20 hertz all the way up to 20,000 hertz. Do we know what a hertz is? It's a complete cycle per second. So, you know, if you look at the sine wave, it goes up once, goes down once, it comes back to the starting point. That's one cycle. 20 hertz is 20 of those in 1 second. 20,000 is 20,000 times up and down in 1 second. It's pretty fast. So keep that in mind as we go forward. So logically then, as you look at the left side, those are low frequencies because it's not happening as often relative to the high frequencies on the right. Distance between them is octaves, and you can see that I've put some numbers on the top there of what notes they are. For any musicians that are in the room, you can take a look and see what notes those represent. Piano's pretty cool because it's got a really wide range of sounds that it can play. What type of instrument is a piano, by the way? Is it a string instrument? Is it a wind instrument? It's actually percussion. because there's little hammers in there that hit the strings, which to me is cool. Anything that's percussion, I like. So I like pianos. Who knows the Blue Man Group? Sorry, I'm going off on a tangent already. Who knows the Blue Man Group? You ever see their show? They play a piano the way I'd like to play a piano. They take a grand piano, they take the cover off of it, and they take a giant mallet and they hit all the strings with it. That's what I like. I like playing piano like that. Anyway, so Jay, we ready?
Yep.
What I'm going to do for everyone is we got an audio system set up here. We're going to take advantage of the sub that's over on the side and this full-range product up here, and we're going to play different tones. We're going to start down to 20 hertz and go all the way up to 20.8 kilohertz, and I want to see if you guys can hear this, and if you've never heard the range, this could be enlightening. Okay, so are we ready?
Yep.
It's 20, 40, 80, 160. 320, 640, 1.3K, get ready, 5.2, 10.4, actually I think I missed one. We started at 40, now we're at 20.8. Who here is 20.8? Dogs are freaking out everywhere, because they can hear higher frequencies where we can't. So it is kind of enlightening. Now, there could be other things coming into play. It may be possible that this particular speaker can't play 20.8K very effectively. Do you blame it? You really can't hear it anyway, so it's not that big of a deal. It really just adds an airiness to sound. But it's pretty interesting to hear the full range of human hearing like that. I think it's exciting. How many know what pink noise is? Ever see one of these things? This is an RTA, a real-time analyzer. This is somewhat archaic by today's standards because you can actually get something like this and put it on your iPhone. So if you're interested in something like that, that's a pretty cool piece of equipment there. But you can plug it into your iPhone and get something very similar to what this is capable of doing. And if you could see it up close, you'd see that it has little dots that represent each one of those octaves over there. And what pink noise is not a series of test tones like we've just played. It's actually equal energy at each one of those octaves. And these little lights represent how loud it is at each one of those. So much like a sine wave is useful for us to determine what's changing in a signal, a real-time analyzer or RTA can let us know how well our audio equipment is reproducing equal energy at all those frequencies. So a lot of people think that an ideal frequency response is a completely flat line. In a clinical setting, perhaps that may be true, but when we actually listen to it, it doesn't sound really that good. So what we're going to do now is just play a brief section of pink noise to give you guys an idea of what that might sound like, and let's see how good our room is. So that's pink noise, and anyone who could see the response curve up here, it had a lot more bass than it did of the mids and highs, bass being on the left side and the mids and highs being on the right. But what's kind of interesting, we didn't do that this morning or yesterday when we set it up, the transition between frequencies is pretty smooth, and our hearing usually picks up on the transitions much more than it pick up on the relative differences from from highs to lows. So now you know what pink noise sounds like, and now you know what test tones sound like. We're going to play some more of those in a little bit. Any questions so far? No? Doing okay? All right. When we talk about loudness, and believe me, there's a lot of loudness going on here. When we talk about loudness, we're usually referring to something called dBs. But dB by itself is somewhat of a meaningless term. dB is a relative term, and usually we're comparing it to something else. So dB can actually be done on light bulbs. If you have a 3-watt bulb and you go to a 6-watt bulb, that's a change of 3 dB. We've doubled our power at that point. But we don't talk about light bulbs. We talk about audio systems. So we're usually talking about, what are those magic letters? SPL, which stands for? Sound pressure level. So we're measuring dB SPL. Without the SPL, it's meaningless. It's like saying that this speaker is going to be half off. How much does it cost? You don't know. Half off what? When you say dB, you're kind of leaving out the important part, SPL. So dB SPL is a measurement of sound relative to something. You know what it's relative to? Absolute silence. Well, actually just a tiny little hair above that. Absolute silence is something that's extremely uncomfortable for people to listen to. It's haunting, it's freaky, it's weird. Have you ever heard of an anechoic chamber? What is an anechoic chamber? Well, if you break down what anechoic actually is, anechoic means without echo. And what it's really referring to is that the room itself does not contribute any energy to your hearing whatsoever. It's anechoic, it does nothing. It's a real hard room to get into. Now let's use this room for an example. Let's see how quiet this room is. So I'm going to shut up and we're going to listen to the room and see if you hear absolute silence. Ready? What do you hear? Some odd, it's not the speaker, it's actually, maybe it's the house speakers or something like that, but it's an annoying little hiss. I keep having to go to the, oh, never mind. but it's an annoying noise, but there's always noises in this room. And when I speak, there's reflections off of all of these things. Now, an anechoic chamber has no hisses. It has no lights, because lights themselves can make little ticking and buzzing noises on their own. The hiss is so loud you don't hear them in this room. So an anechoic chamber would have absolutely no sound whatsoever. And it's freaky. If you were to sit in one of these rooms, you'd have to sit for reasons I'll explain in a second. So you get into this room and you have a seat and you relax. And it's hard to relax because you're going to start hearing different things. And at some point, the absence of sound around you will lead you to hear only one, maybe two things. What are you hearing? You start to hear your heartbeat, which is not a comfortable thing. And if you listen really carefully, you might actually hear the blood going through the blood vessels in your ear, near your eardrum. It is not a fun experience whatsoever. Now, the other thing that you might pick up on if you fidget a little bit in your chair and move a little bit is a low-frequency grumble. And I will not ask you to do this, but for the analogy, if you were to take your fingers and put them into your ear and hold them there so that you tried to block out all external sounds, you would hear a low-frequency grumbling noise. Any idea what that is? It's the muscles in your arm twitching to hold your fingers in your ear. And if you're a gorilla, you have much bigger muscles and it would be a much lower frequency. So bass guys are like, yeah, I'm a gorilla. Because we like low frequencies. But everything in your body makes noise, and an anechoic chamber would be the absence of anything other than those noises. That's 0 dB SPL. And everything else is measured up from that. And instead of using bells, we use decibels. So what does the term decibel actually mean? Who's that? It's 1/10 of a bell, which isn't a whole lot, but it's logarithmic. As you go up the scale from 1 bell all the way up to 10 bells, one decibel all the way up to 10 decibels, you wind up getting what's known as a doubling of perceived loudness. So 1 bell is a doubling of perceived loudness. 1 decibel is 1/10 of that. You want to hear it? Let's see if you can. The first track I have is an error. It's a 40 hertz track that doesn't change. We forgot to make the edit. So we'll just play that quickly so you can get a reference. What we're going to do from now forward with the audio system, between today and tomorrow, we're not going to change the level of the audio system. It's going to remain consistent so that you can hear relative changes. So Jason's going to play a 40 hertz track, just so you hear what it sounds like. That's not 40 hertz.
1,000 hertz track.
Okay. Can you redo that track? All right, he's going to play a 1,000 hertz track, and we're going to hear at some point the level change by 1 dB. And I'm going to cheat and leave this on, so it should actually show it. So somewhere in the track is going to change by 1 dB, tiny little dB.
Now
please.
Can I play it?
Yes, you can, please.
There.
If I didn't have the RTA on, was it a big difference? Sine waves are easy.
You guys up front heard it. The guys in back, it was probably a lot harder to hear.
Was it hard to hear back there? Yeah. Oh, you're cheating back there. He's got a handheld RTA over there, so he's picking up the changes. Cheater. I'm watching you. Okay, so we want to play the 50 hertz just for the hell of it? It's not going to change. I don't think it does. Whatever. Sine waves, however, would be easy for us to pick up the changes relative to music. We've talked about sine waves, how they always repeat, and I showed you how music is always changing. It's real hard to get a reference on it. So we're going to play a track that you'll soon grow tired of, and we're going to change the level at one point by 1 dB, and I'm going to block the RTA so you can't cheat. So here's a change of 1 dB somewhere in the track. Hit it, Jay.
Oh,
Who thinks they heard it? Liars. It's real hard to hear. The next few tracks, you'll see if you were right or not. So I don't know if you were right, but we'll see in the next few tracks because the changes are going to get more significant. A 1 dB change is insignificant in terms of what our hearing can pick up on. But let me tell you this. Everything we just played, except for the bass one, which didn't work right, but the test tone and the music track, to get a change of 1 dB, guess how much more power we would need? 26% more power. So let's just say it was a 100-watt amplifier at that steady tone. To get that slight change that you did pick up on, but it wasn't dramatic, you need 126 watts. If it was 1,000 watts, you start seeing how it gets to be challenging. Music's the same way. So just because the test tone was easy and the music was harder, I only had a few hands go up when they heard the change. So now we're going to talk about something a bit more significant. We're going to talk about a change of 3 dB. Now, a lot of people know that if you double the power, you get 3 dB. And a lot of people think, particularly customers that don't really know, they think if they get that, you know, instead of the 500-watt amp, I'm going to get the 1,000-watt because I want it to be much louder. And they will get a 3 dB change, all things being equal. So, Jay, if we can play whatever track is next, at some point you're going to hear a 3 dB change. A lot easier to hear that, I think. Even the people in the back who aren't cheating probably heard that. Now, the bass tone. Pretty obvious there. It's annoying how the lights vibrate, though, huh? So now let's listen to music and see who heard it before. I think most of us heard that. Were you right? Did you hear it before? It's tough to hear before, though. A lot easier now with the doubling of power. Doubling. That 100-watt amp, now 200 watts. 1,000-watt amp, 1,000 watts. SPL guys, who's my SPL crew? If you're getting beat by 3 dB and you got a 5,000-watt audio system, guess what you need? 10,000 watts. Can you get it? Maybe. Can the speakers handle it? Maybe. You start to see the significance of power when it comes into all these things. Be careful if we're talking to customers and they get all excited about buying that 1,000-watt amplifier because they want it to be twice as loud as their 500-watt amplifier. That's the change that you're likely to hear. Yes, it's louder. I like to refer to it like one or two clicks on the volume control because that's really about all it is in terms of the music level. But it does require a doubling in power. By the way, it also works in reverse. If you cut the power in half, you'll lose 3 dB. But I want to talk about something more significant. I want to talk about a 6 dB change and then a 10 dB change. So let's go through these kind of quick. Let's do a 6 dB change with the tones and music and then a 10 dB change. We'll talk more about that.
I hope I'm not lost now.
Pretty big change there. And now with bass, the beginning part is attenuated, obviously. Did it work? I didn't look. Work. And now with music. That took a lot more power. A lot more, like four times the power. That 100-watt amp is 400 watts. 1,000 watt goes to 4,000 watts. It's a pretty significant change. How about an average level, the perceived loudness? Some people think that's about twice as loud. It's pretty darn close. What's truly twice as loud from all the testing that they've done is a 10 dB change. So let's go ahead and do those, please, Jay. Please. I hope you all heard that. Go. And now with music. There you go. That takes 10 times the amplifier power. That little 100-watt amplifier is now that 1,000-watt amplifier. It's a pretty significant change in terms of perceived loudness, but it takes a significant amount of power. The other thing you have to remember, that just because you have the power doesn't mean your speakers can handle it, which is why we attenuate the beginning of the track and then go the full volume at the end. So how was the level on that ending part, that last part of the music? Was it loud enough in the back? You hear it okay? And you were able to hear a lot of those changes and some of the subtleties perhaps? It's going to come into play tomorrow. Please let me know that you're going to be here tomorrow, I hope. People?
Yes.
Good. Cool. Because tomorrow we have a lot of fun. Not that today's not fun, mind you. What's that? Well, I'll do magnets all day long if you want. There's a chart.
He'll
in,
be doing a magnet show in his room later tonight.
Easy there, Jay.
Sorry.
I do want to share with you something that's on page 16 in the handout.
Well, what Steve pointed out is really important because I know when I was in retail, I mean, I just assumed that when you doubled power, it was double the loudness. And where that comes into play is, say a customer is buying a system and you have a certain budget to work with and maybe they have a small vehicle, so you don't have a ton of airspace, it doesn't have a lot of alternator juice, you know, and he wants a 12W7. Do you sell him the 500-watt amp or the 1,000-watt amp? Most people would go for the 1,000-watt amp. Well, you just heard what the difference is. Now, granted, we're not listening to 1,000 watts of power here, but the incremental change is exactly the same. In that situation, the guy's got a smaller car, he doesn't have a lot of alternator juice, you could do a 500-watt amplifier and it's probably going to be fine on that system. Not to mention, you know, the difference in cost between a 500 and a 1,000-watt amplifier.
Shift that to door speakers. Better door speakers to go with the high-powered sub.
If you have a better budget or a budget to work with, scale back on the sub-amp and use those dollars for the mids and highs, which is overall going to make the system sound better. A lot of times people perceive loudness and the sound quality is just in the bass region when it's really only about 20% of the audio spectrum, as Steve showed earlier. It's only 2 octaves. So take those bunnies and put them elsewhere and they're going to have an overall better system. But that's a very common misnomer in our industry, is the doubling of power and the 3 dB rule and what you're actually getting. And when it's used incorrectly, it's very dangerous. Has anybody ever had a customer that, and whether you sold it to them or maybe they just demanded it, went from a 500-watt amp to a 1,000-watt amp and then they weren't really happy, they didn't get what they expected? So now you can actually get into more details on why. You know, I know it's nice, you know, well, you want that sale, but again, we want those things that Steve pointed out in the beginning. So now you can get into more detail of, look, you really don't need that 1,000-watt amp. It's really only 3 dB, and that's only a couple of clicks of the volume control. It's not doubling of output or doubling of loudness.
Indeed. Great point. We like system design. That's, you know, I enjoy doing that for customers and for dealers, whoever needs it. I like setting up systems that makes the best use of a customer's budget. And what Jason just shared with us, instead of selling, you know, excess power that you're really not going to perceive much of a benefit from, shifting the money that you would have spent on that into something that's going to make a more balanced system, which will come into play again tomorrow.
I mean, keep in mind when a customer comes in, and I'm relating to JL Audio product, but a customer comes in and says, oh, I just got to have a 13W7. What are they really implying they're looking for?
A lot of bass.
A
lot of it.
Guess what? We have a lot of other products, and you guys probably sell other brands as well, that can get them a lot of bass. Now, maybe they came in asking for the W7 because it's the bell cow or the holy grail of woofers. Yes. But if they say they're looking to buy that, one, they've already told you maybe a little bit of budget they'll work with, and they told you they want it loud. And then you can work with that. Just don't sell them the product because they asked for it. They may not know what they really want. And that's why, as a salesperson, you have to really qualify, ask the right questions.
Excellent points.
Although sell lots of W7s.
We're okay with you selling those. It's really.
They don't know what they really want.
No, they don't.
They don't. And honestly, they're afraid of salespeople. And I really don't blame them, because some people in our industry have not been really kind to customers. They just take money and say whatever. And we need to change that. Well, oftentimes what I have found, if I can speak into that, he said that oftentimes they know what they want, they just don't know how to get there. And that's what we're here for. You know, when we start thinking about what we do, we need to make choices based on what their real performance expectations are. And I get a little excited about this, but what you're saying is so true. Customers come in and their friend had, you know, 2 12W7s or something like that, and I got to have that. Well, why do you have to have that in your, you know, pickup truck with, you know, it's a standard cab pickup truck? You can't do that. It's just, you're going to have to make compromises. It's not going to perform well. And remember, we're looking to exceed performance expectations, but if they don't tell you what performance they're looking for, they just tell you product, how do you exceed those expectations? So like Jason said, someone comes in looking for a big, massive subwoofer with lots of power, they want bass. We can do that. Maybe not with exactly what they've asked for. Maybe have the conversation, hey, you know what? That system would probably kick some butt in one vehicle, but it may not be best for yours. Let's go take a look at it. Let's take a look at your vehicle, see what we can do, and I guarantee you that I'll blow your mind with the system I put in. And after you're done with this class, you'll be able to know exactly how to do that. But the point is, get to the root of what the customer is looking for. If they want a lot of bass, get them a lot of bass. Whatever it takes to get them a lot of bass within their budget, exceed those expectations. Make proper choices. Shift monies to where you actually need them to get the perceived benefit. You know, Jason touched on something, and he did it kind of quick, and I hope everyone caught it. When we had the range of human hearing up there, it went from 20 to 20,000. If you broke down the octaves and bothered to count them, which nobody ever does, the first two octaves goes from 20 to 40, 40 to 80. Where's the most common crossover point for subwoofers? 80. Right around 80 hertz. So the first two octaves are covered by the sub. There's eight more of them that go above that. 80% of what the customer hears comes from the doors. We should be selling door speakers and amps all day long. But what a customer is always asking for? Bass. And there is two reasons for that. One, it's fun and it's exciting. The other hidden reason is 50% of the energy content lives in those two octaves alone. That's why it's exciting and fun. And that's all good. But if you ignore the mids and highs, the best subwoofer system that you're ever going to sell sounds horrible without the mids and highs to complement it. Keep that in mind. 80% of the tone and 50% of the energy is coming from the doors. Don't forget them.
When we originally started shipping the W7s, we had a dealer that called in, and a lot of you guys will laugh, but it happened. They said, hey, we did this system, two 12W7s, I think it was two 500-1s.
2000s.
Two 1000s, it's an extended cab pickup truck, it doesn't sound right. Okay, so what was the enclosure? Enclosure was built to spec. You know, went through the settings of the amplifiers, went through everything that we thought could contribute to making the product sound bad. And then we said, well, what else is in the system? That's it. Factory mids and highs, factory head unit. So they'd bought two 12W7s, two 1000/1s, so you're talking $4,000 to $5,000 worth of product, and they wondered why it didn't sound good.
And for salespeople who cringe at us telling you not to sell like that, think of this. If we took that same $4,000 or $5,000 and sold them one W7 or high-end woofer and one 1000-watt amplifier to drive it and took the rest of the budget, put some really good door speakers in, another amp and maybe a proper source unit and some good wire, it's about the same sale. But the customer said he wants more. Fine, sell them more after that, because you've already got a great platform, a high-powered sub with a good amplifier, good door speakers and a proper amplifier wired up. Wow, that sounds great. I want more. That's business growth. That's what we're looking for. We've given him performance that exceeded expectations, and now he's raised them. He wants even more. That's fantastic. We can do that, hopefully. Selling the experience. All right, so this chart, I got to tell you, every time I do this training, I look at this chart and I say, damn, that's like the Rosetta Stone of audio. There's so much great information in this chart, I encourage you to look at it very carefully. I like pointing out the second blue line down. It says 2 times power in watts equals 1.41 times voltage / excursion equals 3 dB. What we've already talked about today, where did you see 1.41? That was the peak to RMS earlier? There's a relationship there. Double the voltage gives you 3 dB. Sorry, 41% more voltage gives you 3 dB. And it does so by moving the speaker 41% further. So the other side of the equation that we were talking about when we started going from 100 watts to 1,000 watts when we did the 10 dB change is that the speaker's got to move a hell of a lot more too. And that's where the output benefit comes from. So it's not only a matter of can the coil handle it, it's can the speaker move that far. Take a look at the last one. 10 times the power, what we did before, 10 times the power moves the speaker 3.16 times further than it was before. And that's where you're getting the 10 dB of increased output. That is a really powerful chart. Just so you know, the whole thing is reversible, and this is the opposite way. As you cut power, you see the reduction. Page 16. Keep it open on your desk at all times.
Where this can get dangerous too is when, you know, now most amplifiers have bass knobs. And usually what do those bass knobs adjust up to? How much boost? 10 dB. So when they grab that knob and turn it up all the way, and if a gain is not set up properly, they're asking that amplifier to produce 10 times more power.
And your speaker to move more than 3 times further at that one frequency. That's a speaker killer, or an alternator killer, or both.
If the gain's set up properly and the system's designed right, there's nothing wrong with those knobs, but you can see how it can be catastrophic.
There's one more aspect of SPL we need to talk about. It's how far away the mic is from the source. And as you double the distance, logically, like we've been talking, doubling things or having things, it's a change of In this case, it's six, actually, not three. A lot of people think that it's three. We just want to point out that as you pull further away, you're dealing with a half space measurement, so you're actually changing 6 dB. It's highly unlikely that you're ever going to experience this in a car. It's also highly unlikely you could experience that in this room. Why? Any guesses why that clinical definition would not work in this room? You hear all those echoes and that reflective surface? All that extra energy is going to change the reading on a microphone. But you do need to change. What you do need to know is if you did remove all the echoes and vibrations and other noise things and bouncing things in a room, you could see a 6 dB change as you double. The only thing I will share with you is there is a situation in a car that you can hurt yourself. Customer comes in, my tweeters don't seem to be working. So what are we likely to do? Put the system on, play it, and then get really close to the speaker to see if that tweeter's playing. Hopefully it's not a loose wire that suddenly connects when you're right next to the speaker, because suddenly you'll have a lot of energy coming right into your ear and that could hurt you. So don't do that, please. Check the wires first. All right, some things that Jason kind of touched on. If you had a speaker that was playing at 100 dB with 100 watts and you had another speaker exactly the same as the first one, basically you doubled the piston area, you will gain 3 dB. Did you know that? Now, in practice, when you take one speaker and add another one that's identical to it on an amplifier, what else changes usually? The impedance, and therefore the power capacity of the amplifier oftentimes will change. So when you see this, this is accurate because the power input is consistent. But if you double the power as well, if you double the power as well, go from 100 watts to 200 watts into the two speakers, you get 3 dB for the power and 3 dB for the doubling of the piston area. It's not just a matter of adding speakers, though, because if you wanted to go to another speaker, that would be adding a third speaker, but it's not a doubling of the piston area. To get another 3 dB, you'd have to go from two speakers up to four speakers of identical size. And it also doesn't work like you go from an 8 and add a 15. Obviously, there's a difference in piston area. And don't do that. It's a really bad idea. So that's how the speaker aspect all plays into that. We good?
Where else could you get another, say, 3
dB? Change the enclosure.
Yeah, change the enclosure. You go from sealed to ported, you gain another 3 dB. So these are all what we'll call is like free output, as opposed to adding an amplifier, which costs a lot more money and has a big impact on the system. Does everybody know how to compute cone area of a woofer? How do you compute cone area of a woofer?
I cheat. I look in the owner's manual.
If you look in the owner's manual, there's a term called SD, and it'll give you the surface area. But if you want to, say, do a 12-inch woofer, it's pi times radius squared. So 3.14 times 6 times 6.
We just had Pi Day, didn't we?
Yeah, 3.14. I'm sure you celebrated.
We did. We had apple pie. It was great. Pi Day, March 14th, 3.14. I'm getting no love from this group.
I don't blame them. All right. So the cone area of a 12 is 113 square inches. Let's just look at a 10. 3.14 times 5 times 5.
We were hoping you guys would do the math, but since no one jumped on it earlier.
So it's 78.5. I'm going to multiply it by 2. 157. So that guy that wanted the single 12W7 and a 501, but say he doesn't have the money for the woofer, what if you got him into two 10W3s? Less money. Which has more cone area? Yeah, it's going to play louder on the two 10s. And arguably, the difference in airspace for two 10s versus single 12 is probably the same as well. So if this is a guy that's wanting to play loud on a budget, two 10s might be better than the single 12.
The comment from the front of the room was that 12s play deeper. Is that true?
Dog.
Dog, sorry, I forgot the dog.
Randy Jackson's in the... Certainly you have an audible difference between the W7 and W3s, but with larger cone area, these will actually play a little bit lower. The 12W7 obviously has potential to do more things, but if you're limited by power and on a budget, simply you can show them how they're going to get more power as opposed to the guy really maxing that system. Because we said a 512W7 would be fine in a car. There's other things we didn't talk about, like if the guy's going to be running at full tilt all the time, then he might be stressing things. There's issues when you don't have enough power to run a woofer, which we'll talk about tomorrow. But anyways, I wanted to do the cone area comparison because that's a handy tool when you're trying to do things like this and figure out if, you know, one selection of woofers is actually going to be louder than another selection.
I have a feeling that'll come up again very soon.
Yes.
All right.
You're looking at doing that, let's say, with, you know, the three or four product lines that you have to choose from. You're talking a budget. You go from W6 to W3. You're looking at, say, 12W6, and you're trying to compare it to, budget-wise, two 10W3s. There's a little dollar difference there. At what point in that conversation do you get into including the X-Max so that you're taking into account the actual volume displacement to really give a customer a realistic expectation?
With given the same power...
Repeat the question.
What's that?
Repeat the question so the people...
The question was, sorry, that if you're, say you're comparing a 12W6 to a pair of 10W3s, where do you start talking about the X-Max? Because the 12W6 has more X-Maxes, was your question,
right,
correct?
Right, basically. When do you include that factor?
That's a tough one. I mean, this is why it's obviously important to be able to demo products, because at some point you can narrow this down, and then the customer has to listen to it and decide. There's an audible difference between a W6 and a pair of 10W3s in terms of quality. Some people may pick it up, some people won't. In terms of X-Max, the efficiency, it's pretty similar. You shouldn't notice that big of a difference.
That's an excellent question, though, because there are other things that come into play.
If you're staying in 12s, I'm not going to 10s, but just going W6 to 2W3s.
I think it comes back to performance expectations. If they come in and they're just looking for bass, oftentimes your highest quality product, like in our line, be a W6 or a W7 product, maybe is not the best choice for that particular customer. They're looking for a drag strip car, you don't sell them a car that handles real well. You know what I mean? You got to look at what the true performance expectations are. If the customer comes in and talks about wanting to be in an IASCA contest car, then maybe you start looking at that higher level woofer and maybe trying to get them into a single driver that, you know, with a little bit of extra power to get the amplitude we're looking for. But ultimately, in terms of 12s play lower, it's really a function of how loud you want to play at those lower frequencies. And that's where the excursion factor comes into play. Because to play loud at low frequencies requires significant more excursion at those lower frequencies. Just so... For a thought experiment here, if you're playing, let's say, you know, 100 dB at 80 hertz, and you're moving a quarter of an inch at that particular point, if you wanted to play the same 100 dB down one octave lower at 40 hertz, you need to move four times further, four times. So that quarter inch now needs to be an inch just to keep the same level. So if you really think about that, that's where your excursion comes in. Are they likely to really care about, you know, sub 30 hertz frequencies? Everyone says they want to, but no one really actually experiences it. Because most music doesn't go that low. So you have to remember that as you're making these choices. And just a real quick thing, a lot of people think a driver like this one was designed to play loud, loud, loud. It's capable of playing loud, but really it was designed to play low, low, low. And it's not because it's a 10, 12, or 15, or whatever size it may be. It's because it has excursion capability to play those low frequencies as loud as it plays those higher frequencies. If you're just looking for loud, pick a different woofer, because you'll probably get more output from something else. But if you want something that sounds good, look for one that's got linear excursion capability down to whatever. Sorry.
Hey, Steve, would you just let me come in and say hello?
Hi.
And thank you.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
It. Looks like you guys had value for coming in and seeing it. I'm Chris Cook with Mira. Tony Corbett with Mobile Electronics Magazine. Tony Frangioso is installing it. Mark as well. Frangioso. Just wanted to say hi and see how everything was going. Was this good value for you guys?
Yeah.
So how many are going to come to Knowledge Fest in Dallas? All right, man. You got to finish this off and close the deal.
Yep, we'll do.
Okay. We'll do.
Okay, thanks, Chris. Good seeing you. All right, so if we move on, we're doing good on time, no?
Yeah.
Okay. So we're going to talk about waveforms real quick, and this is really more of a refresher than anything else. I kind of showed you guys before, earlier, what music might kind of look like. Well, this is really what music sort of looks like. We drew this. This is not actually a song. But what I wanted to show you is, in addition to the sine wave stuff that I talked about before with the peak, peak-to-peak, and RMS values that we talked about, we have some other things going on here. You still see the peak voltage. You'll also see the average voltage, but now we're looking at amplitude, which is over time. That's the dotted line that goes all the way across. The average amplitude, you see where it says dynamic range? What is dynamic range? If you don't know and you look at the chart, how would you describe it?
The difference from zero to peak.
from zero to peak would be dynamic range. It's how much overall energy is on the particular recording. We're looking at a recording here. But there's another term that you may or may not be familiar with, kind of towards the center there. Crest factor. What do you think crest factor is? It's before we talked about the dynamic range, which is from the zero point to the peak amplitude, the overall window of energy that we have. Crest factor is looking at the average energy compared to the peak energy. Now, we talked earlier that peak energy is somewhat meaningless. It's like peak power on an amplifier. It's such a short period of time that it becomes meaningless. It's the average power that we care about. Crest factor we can look at and determine what the average energy of a particular recording will be. Crest factor is going to be measured in dB. We know dB, it's dBSPL, so we'll just leave that off for the conversation. So what we're talking about here is a change between the peak to the average energy. So something that had a 20 dB crest factor would mean that the average energy is 20 dB less than what the peak would be. So let's do a quick breakdown on that. Let's just say, for ease of conversation, that we had 1,000 watts at the peak. So now we're talking about a 20 dB crest factor, so that means it's 20 dB less than that. Let's break it into chunks. If we go down 10 dB, how much power we have? We had 1,000, down 10 dB is 100. It's 1/10 the power. 1,000 down to 100 is 1/10 the power. 20 dB would be another 10 dB down from 100. 10 watts. So that would mean that the peak energy to the average energy, you go from 1,000 watts in this example down to 10. It's a pretty big change. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a second. Right? We're good?
We're good.
Move on? Okay. What's going on here? Clipping. What is clipping? We're going to talk more about what DC looks like in regards to this. We'll get to tomorrow, actually, so you better be here. But what I like to look at with this is the blue line that you see as it goes across. You see the window of amplitude, that's your top to bottom scale, and you have time, which is your left to right scale. The blue line, as you can see, we're kind of increasing that sine wave up until the point where the dotted lines, which represents our peak voltage capability of whatever it is, be it the head unit or be it an amplifier, we're going past what it's capable of reproducing. And when we do so, you'll see that those red dash lines, people in the back, can you see the red dash lines? Okay, that red dash line represents where the sine wave wants to be based on what you're asking it to do. But it looks like, if you look at the blue line, it looks like someone took a pair of scissors and just clipped that top part off. Hence the term clipping. What we're showing here is that as you start clipping a sine wave, it starts to look more and more like something else that we call a square wave. What is a square wave? If you think about what a square wave would look like on an oscilloscope, it would mean that it goes all the way to the peak, and it instantaneously goes all the way to the next peak, and then instantaneously up to the next peak, as opposed to a sine wave that ramps up and goes down and ramps up. Remember, when it ramps up and goes down, we have to look between the peak and the average. Remember, we kind of talked about that. We don't know what the effective RMS voltage is with AC because it's always changing. But with DC, DC is easy because it's always one value. If you have a perfect square wave, you'll also have one value. It's not actually DC. It's a square wave AC. But the value remains consistent because it's all of the power capability of the device. We'll just call it an amplifier. So when you're running a square wave, it is peak. Because the peak and the average are the same. The crest factor of a square wave would be zero. The peak and the average are identical, as opposed to a sine wave where the peak to average difference is 3 dB, crest factor of 3 dB. So back to that 1,000 watt example, the 1,000 watt at the peak would be an average of 500 watts, as opposed to the peak being 1,000. Should we try to do the video?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to try to quickly do a video here. It's actually a pretty neat little thing, I think anyway. School of sound. Whoops, where'd it go? What are you laughing at?
From last night.
Hey now. Info sine wave demo. Oh, damn it. Here we go. Put this over here. This is going to be split two. I think that'll work. Okay, so what we got here, everyone see that okay in the back? Over here, we have something called amplitude. We've been talking about that. Over here is frequency. It's kind of like what you'd see on an RTA. The red line represents whatever frequency this is. Down here, we have the sine wave playing through, and again, we have amplitude, and we have time as it goes across. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly click on average power over time. You see the shaded area in yellow? That's the amount of power that's going through your speakers or coming from your amplifiers. It's really the same thing. So the more yellow you have, the more power is going to the voice coil of the speaker. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to increase the volume. And as you see, it's starting to get larger and larger, and there's more yellow, more power. The amplitude goes up. You can see the little red bar now in the upper left has gone higher. That's increasing your volume. What now I'm going to do now is I'm going to clip the amplifier a little bit, just a little bit of clipping, and you can see what happens as we turn the volume up. I think. Did I do it? Yeah. There we go. You start seeing that squaring off of that top part of the waveform, but it's real minor. The amount of yellow hasn't really changed a whole lot, so it's real minor clipping. That's not bad. But check out our frequencies. See those additional red bars there? Any idea what those are? It's harmonic distortion. As you clip an amplifier, it's going to create other frequencies above the fundamental frequency. Those red bars represent those harmonic content. They contribute very, very little to the overall energy, but if you were playing this through a tweeter, those higher frequencies that, remember, we couldn't hear, it still represent energy for those small voice coils and can be damaging. But on a subwoofer, that's pretty insignificant. But what is significant is when we, pardon the expression, but clip the hell out of an amplifier like this, severe clipping, you see now it's starting to replicate what a square wave starts to look like. And you can see that the amount of energy at that point is a lot more. As a comparison, let's just say this current amplifier is a 500-watt amplifier. If we compared it to a 1,000-watt amplifier, you can see, it's hard to see, I bet you can't see it in the back, but the red dashes on the top represent what a 1,000-watt amplifier would be able to do. It's about the same amount of average energy over time, but it's not clipping, so all that harmonic stuff would go away. That's a pretty cool little demonstration of what clipping does and how it changes the average power over time. We good? Mm-hmm. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to kill this now and go back to window PowerPoint. There we go. Come back in here. Slight little departure from the PowerPoint. All right, where am I at? There we go. And we're back. Okay. I think we're back. Are we back? No, we're not back. Can you work on this or you want to talk while I get this?
Hey, what's the next slide?
Next slide is we're going to talk about snare drum. Snare drum's next.
All right. So we're going to start to play some instruments, and we're going to look at a couple of different charts and look at what the crust factor is on some of these charts. So again, to understand the amount of average content that's going into the speaker. Here we go.
All right, so I'm sick of sine waves, and I'm sure you are too. So we're actually going to play instruments. Now, I asked earlier if the people in the back could kind of hear the music pretty clearly. What we're going to ask you to do now is identify parts of music. And what I have up here on the chart, this is a snare drum we're going to play for you. It's not really a snare drum. It's a recording of a snare drum. But we're going to play the sound of a snare drum. It's another percussion instrument, so you know I like this. In the upper right-hand corner, you see that weird red squiggly kind of line? That is the frequency response of the recording we're going to play. So it should sort of look like that on this meter here, but it probably won't. But that kind of shows you where the energy of a snare drum is. A lot of people think drums, they think bass. Snare drum really has no bass, as the chart shows. On the left side is bass, on the right side is mids and highs. Down on that lower part, what I really like about this is it actually shows what music looks like. So if you wanted to visualize what music was like, this is a great representation. We've all heard a snare drum, I hope, so you know that the attack of a snare drum is very sudden. And if you look from left to right, that's time passing. So on the left is nothing, and all of a sudden there's a big surge of energy, and then eventually it decays. So you have an attack and a decay. And wherever you see black, that's power. So the more black you have, the more power you have. So you see there's a bunch of energy in the beginning, then it kind of muddles a bit, and then fades out. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and listen to a snare drum and see what that sounds like. See if you can pick up the details.
Sorry.
And what a snare drum sounds like. That's not a snare drum. Neither is that. You're too far ahead. You're ahead.
No, I don't think so.
Well, we didn't play those tracks because we skipped. That's there a snare is. Drum. That's a snare drum. You can hear the attack and you can hear the decay of the music. That's what makes music exciting. It's not just a test tone. There's other things going on. It's more complex than just tones. So we're going to play a couple of other instruments for you to kind of give you a feel for, you know, the way things are in music. The first one we're going to play is a grand piano, again with the percussion. So what we have here, if you look at the spectral chart, which is the upper right, you can see the energy distribution. The note we're playing, if you remember the chart of the piano earlier, this is going to be the C2, which is 65.4 hertz. That's your fundamental tone. But let's look at the chart on the bottom, and you can see there's a bunch of other stuff going on. If you look real carefully, it might be easier if you look at page 20 in your handout. If you look real carefully, you can see that there's more than one thing going on. You can almost see how something like this is taking place, where there's multiple tones. When we play it, see if you can pick up what those other tones might be. Go ahead and play it, please. Could you hear what was going on there? When the hammer hits the string, it causes a vibration, and that vibration causes the other strings to vibrate also. So what you're seeing inside that little waveform behavior at the bottom are the other strings vibrating. You can see what you just heard. That's cool if you ask me, but I don't get out much. So that's what a piano sounds like playing C2. We're going to play another instrument at C2, and this one's a bassoon, which is a woodwind. And if you look at the spectral chart, completely different, even though the fundamental tone's the same. There's harmonic content in this that's going to make it sound different, so you'll say that this is not a grand piano, it sounds like a bassoon. And if you look really carefully at the initial attack of this, it's a little teeny, it's almost like a buzz you can see on there. What do you think that might be? Let's listen to it, see if you pick up on it. Sounds completely different, and yes, it's the reed. As you blow into the instrument, the reed vibrates first, and you can actually see that in the waveform behavior on the bottom. I think that's really cool. You can also see the two tones kind of vibrating within each other as a result of the woodwind instrument being played. Next one I want to play for you is a double bass, member of the string family. Again, the spectral plot is completely different, even though the fundamental tone is identical. It's still the C2, 65.4 hertz. And if you look at that wave behavior, you know I'm going to get excited because you can see the other strings moving. Go ahead and play that, please. And you could clearly hear more than one thing going on with that. Could you hear that in the back pretty clearly? Were you able to pick up on the detail and resolution of what we were playing? Because it's real important that you can, because as we go forward, we want to play music, and we want to, I'm getting a little excited here, I'm getting a good look. Music, I mean, you said sell the experience, right? Well, what we just played, that's the experience. It's actual instruments. It's not sine waves and pink noise and all that test tone crap. It's musical instruments designed so that you can pick up the detail and resolution. And I don't care what kind of music you like. It really makes no difference. If it's well recorded and sounds good, play it loud all day long. That's what it's all about. So let's go ahead and compare all of these things together. The snare just being no reference to talk about how music is looks like. But the next three, they're all the same fundamental frequency, and yet they're all different. It's those differences that I want to focus on for the rest of the day today and into tomorrow when we talk about speaker power handling and more about crest factor. So I want to talk about clipping just a little bit more. Timing is almost perfect, right?
Yeah.
All right, so this is kind of a neat thing that we got. Who remembers Richard Clark and Dave Navone, the guys that did AutoSound 2000? These guys were fantastic. They had this company where basically their fundamental purpose was to help educate our industry. You know I like that because I love doing things like this, you know, talking about how to make great sounding audio systems. These guys were dedicated to it. And what they did was they would point out a principle of audio or some types of physics that goes into what we do. And then they would test it and show you the results of their test that help confirm or maybe break down some of the myths that are out there. We loved it. One thing that they did, fortunately for us for this presentation, was they took one of our amplifiers, a 300/4, which is a 4x150 amplifier. That's irrelevant to everything. But what they did was they took the output of the amplifier and measured it as the amplifier went into clipping. What they were trying to show is how amplifiers behave when they're pushed beyond their limits. We've seen sine waves when they clip. That's a little scissor analogy that I showed. But music is different. Amplifiers can misbehave when they clip. So they wanted to take a look at what that misbehavior looked like. So what we're going to actually play, it's really strange to think about it, but we're actually going to play the recording of the output of an amplifier. You see what I'm doing there? It's not the recording itself that's clipped, it's the output of the amplifier that's clipped. And what we're going to do first, we're going to play it clean. Now, if you look at the waveform up there, you'll see some spikes, and you'll see not a whole lot of black energy. You'll see some odd, you know, patterns and stuff. That's music. That's the exciting aspect of things. The peaks, you can clearly see, and the average is kind of hard to pick up. This doesn't have my crest factor on it, though, does it?
unless it comes when you hit a button.
No, it doesn't. If you go on page 21, you can kind of follow along with this a little bit better. The crest factor of this particular recording is just a little bit more than 20. I think it's 21.2 is the crest factor of this recording, which means those peaks, that's our reference point. If we come 20 dB down from that, using my 1,000-watt analogy again, the average energy is 10 watts. Not a hell of a lot of power. So we told you we wouldn't change the level, so we'll play this with a 20 dB plus crest factor, listen to it, pick up the details in the music though. You could identify all the instruments pretty easily. It sounded pleasing enough if you like that style of music, but the point here is you could pick out all the instruments and it was not clipped. It was fine. Now what we're going to do is we're going to clip it a lot. We're going to clip it by 12 dB. Holy cow. 12 dB we're going to clip it by. The changing crest factor, as you'll see in your book, has gone from 21.2 way down to 17. So if I clipped it by 12 dB, how come it didn't change by 12 dB? What clipped? All the spikes clipped, but my average didn't clip at this point. Only the peaks clipped. Remember, we've run out of power at the peaks. So by clipping the peaks, we've raised the average level, but not by the same amount of what the clipping is. To illustrate that, look at the chart there. In your book, it might be easier to follow along. You'll notice that some of the wave behaviors are now larger. They're bigger, kind of like the movie I played a moment ago, the little flash thing we did, where the waveform got larger and there was more yellow. Well, we've done the same thing here, and we've changed our crest factor by more or less 3 dB, which means our average energy, our average power over time has increased by 3 dB, which is double. So before, if we had 10 watts of average energy, we've now increased that by double, right? So we're at 20 watts of average power. Let's see, first of all, if it's louder. It should be, and also see if you can pick up on the horrendous amount of distortion that we put into this track. Listen to the instruments. Boy, that sounded horrible, huh? Did it? Sounded fine. It's a little bit louder. Oh, by about 3 dB or so. Because we've doubled our average amount of energy. The crest factor changed by more or less 3 dB. So we expected it to be a bit louder, not overwhelming. But because we clipped it, we sort of maybe thought that it should sound bad. But it really didn't. If you were really paying attention, some of the highs were not quite as crisp as they were, a little spitty now. The mid-bass had a little bit of a thump to it that wasn't there before. That's the clipping aspect that you've picked up on those peaks of the music, but the average energy wasn't affected. Now we're going to clip the living hell out of the amplifier. We're going to clip it by 24 dB. Now all our crest factors show up. So now we went from 21.2 to 17. Now we've clipped it by 24 dB, and our crest factor is a wonderful 6.8 dB. So let's just say that's 10. We've basically, compared to the first live, has 10 times the average energy. Do you think it'll be louder? Look at the waveform behavior on that bottom one there. Do you see where things are clipping a little bit more often? The average energy now that was not clipped on the first one and barely clipped, if at all, on the second one, most of the average energy is now clipped. Let's see if you can pick up on a subtle difference in terms of the way the recording sounds. Yeah, baby.
I think I heard that playing out back earlier.
Yeah, I think you did.
It's playing out front, too.
The comment was, I think I heard that playing out back earlier. Well, the reality is you probably did, because people clip the life out of their audio systems because most of them just don't care. Now, here's the thing. That track is probably not being played out there. They're playing other things. Our hearing is real sensitive to clipping in mid-range and high frequencies. You could really get away with clipping a bass amplifier a bit more and get away with it. And I'm cool with that because I like a lot of bass. I admit it. I'm somewhat of a bass head when it comes to that. I don't necessarily listen to bass music, but I like it a little extra bass. But what you picked up on, which was clearly obvious, was all the average energy now has been clipped. We don't want to play that movie today, do we? It's tomorrow,
no,
right?
Tomorrow.
Okay. So what you see there is a change in the average energy over time. that change in crest factor is really the big difference is what's gone on. What I want to talk about tomorrow with Jason is loudspeaker power handling and how that type of stuff that we just experienced, what you've heard out back and we've all experienced in our careers, how that's damaging to speakers, to electrical systems, to profitability, to customer satisfaction. What we need to focus on is not music specifically. You obviously heard a change. The detail and resolution changed dramatically as we went into more and more clipping. That was with a highly dynamic recording with very high peaks and very low averages. A lot of recordings, as we'll see tomorrow, are not done quite the same way. And what's important is that the increase in average energy over time is dramatic as we start clipping amplifiers. We're done a few minutes early, which is a bit surprising for Jason and I. Do we have questions about today's content? Anything at all? No questions at all? Everyone's pretty comfortable with... Yes, there will be a test on magnets, but you'll have to come tomorrow to find out what those questions will be. I'll give you all the answers tomorrow. What we covered today really is what our customers are expecting from us, and I think we got that pretty clear. We covered Ohm's law and power calculations and some tricks and techniques that we could use to use that in our business. We talked about, what else we talked about? We talked about the 3 dB rule, the 10 dB rule, how loudness affects things. We learned about octaves and the range of human hearing. We learned about how to apply that into different things, and now we started talking about clip waveforms and music. Tomorrow, we're going to put this stuff all together, talk about loudspeaker power handling, the effect music has on that. We'll talk about music over different genres and decades, and then we're going to get into charging systems, and then finally systems design and how to make really good choices based on all the stuff we talk about. I really thank you all very much for being here today. I know it's late in the day and everyone wants to go out party, because I know you want to do that. But thank you again. I'm really looking forward to seeing you tomorrow, and we'll see you then. Thank you.
Anybody have any questions on stuff we covered yesterday? Still soaking it all in. Cool. Well, we're going to start off with loudspeaker power handling, and then we're going to get into music and how music's recorded and the effect it actually has on the system. And then we're going to talk about vehicle charging systems and wrap it up with some system design.
Speaking of that, do you have those systems out?
Yes.
All right, cool.
So if you're following along, page 22 in the book is where we're at. So we ended yesterday with a slide. Steve had it up earlier, but what happens when you clip a system? What does it actually do? Well, now you just stole my thunder.
Sorry, there it's gone.
It increases your average power over time, which is essentially what kills speakers. But there's a lot of myths out there of what actually kills speakers. Some of us have probably used them. I know I used them when I was in retail, and we want to go over those because it's dangerous if they're used with a customer. Sometimes a customer may come in using these things. So there's a couple of truths we have to talk about first. I think Steve touched on it yesterday, that customers are always going to lie. They're not going to tell the truth. So
they do.
How many times have you had a customer come in and they had a problem with their system and they say, man, I don't know what happened. You know, it was playing fine Saturday. Sunday I got up and...
It wasn't loud.
It wasn't loud. I was listening to the news.
I was listening to the news, really, and suddenly everything just blew up.
I'm an abuser,
yes. Yeah,
you caught that, huh?
They're not going to always tell the truth, and we have to understand that. But let's go into some of the myths.
Well, what's the other truth? Everybody clips their audio system, at least a little bit. And if they're not clipping, they're just not trying hard enough. If you actually listen to an amplifier, even a very powerful amplifier, without clipping it, you'd be really disappointed at the level that you get. We'd have a hard time selling any amplifiers unless you could drive them a little bit beyond what they're supposed to do. And we kind of touched on it yesterday when we were playing some of this. A little bit of clipping on a lot of different recordings is quite acceptable and actually is okay. It's when we get ridiculous, and that's what Jason's going to cover for us now, is when you get stupid with the clipping. So two truths. Customers lie, and everybody clips. Cool? We go with that? All right. How many have heard this myth before? How many have used this myth before of having too little powers blows woofers? If you really, really think about it, I mean, I know I've used this as, oh, that amp's way too small for that woofer, you're going to blow it up. But if you actually look at the words, having too little power blows woofers, if this were true, if this were really an accurate statement, every time you turn the volume down, poof, everything would blow up. Because you're reducing the amount of power, so having too little power, if that's what kills things. So you see why this is not true. But I'm willing to bet that everyone that was willing enough to raise their hand at this hour in the morning that admitted hearing this and possibly even saying this was probably thinking something else. What were you thinking? What the hell were you thinking? What were you thinking when you saw this up there and said, that's true?
What's that?
That if you had too little power, you'd be trying to drive the amp.
Maybe what he's saying is by having too little power, you're going to try to overdrive the amplifier and try to force it to do something it's not supposed to do, which, of course, as we know from yesterday, forces it into clipping. We saw a little sine wave thing with the clip. Remember that? But a lot of people think that clipping, by causing, like, harmonic distortion, blows woofers, right? Well, here, let me just put this up because here's a hint. If it's on the board, it ain't true. Now, we did touch yesterday very briefly on the fact that, remember I showed that little flash interactive thing where I showed a sine wave clipping, and in the upper left-hand corner we had put about the fundamental frequency and then the harmonic content. When you clip an amplifier, it does create harmonic information that's at a higher frequency. So when we talk about clipping an amplifier and it going into distortion and causing harmonic issues, it may have an effect on smaller drivers like mid-range and tweeters, but when you're dealing with a subwoofer of any decent size, each subwoofer has a giant one of these on it. What is this? It's a voice coil, but let's take the voice part of it out and just call it a coil. Where else do you see coils? In crossovers. And what do coils and crossovers do? Filter out what? High frequency. So all that high frequency harmonic content, it doesn't do crap to a woofer. It has no significant contribution to the heat, which is ultimately what kills the speaker. So clipping, by causing harmonic distortion, it doesn't do anything to a woofer. What it does do is increases the average energy over time, like we saw yesterday and what Jason was mentioning. And it's an increase in average power over time that causes speakers to fail. You don't get to this quickly. This takes a lot of heat over a long period of time, and we're going to show you why and how that happens. What about that DC part of it? Someone yesterday, I think, mentioned something about clipping in DC.
It was Spike.
You're giving me a salute there? He's number one, yeah. A lot of people think that clipping causes DC. The reality is it may trick your multimeter into showing a DC reading, but it's not actually DC. It's either pulse DC, kind of what we talked about with the square wave effect, but it's not actually DC. Even a cheap flea market amplifier with the built-in alarm, it's not going DC on you. If it's going DC, you have other issues to worry about than what's happening to your subwoofer. So in reality, clipping, by causing harmonic distortion, does not blow woofers. It doesn't make DC, and having too little power is not what kills it. It's an increase in average power over time that's going to kill a woofer. Right. Next, what do we have? You ever hear this one? You need to run at least twice the power that the woofer's rated for in order for it to get loud. So everyone that was here yesterday should be chuckling a little bit and knows the answer of why this is on the board. So why is this on the board? I'm going to drag it out of you guys. I know it's early. What's that?
If you double the power, you're going to get twice as loud.
Well, that's the other myth, that if you double the power, you're going to get twice as loud. But what happens when you do double the power? What do you get?
3 dB.
3 dB. And as we heard yesterday, while it's a nice improvement, it's not that significant. But think of the consequences. Think of what you're actually doing. Let's say you had a 1,000-watt amplifier, or the woofer's rated for 1,000 watts, so you put a 1,000-watt amp on it. Sounds great, but you need at least twice that power for it to get really loud. So you sell them 2,000 watts of power. What have you done? You set yourself up for failure, and why? Two reasons mostly. One is you've doubled the amount of heat going through the voice coil, and that, remember my examples over here, remember that that's going to cause a major problem over duration, right? And the other thing is by doubling the amount of amplifier power, you're also doubling the current draw from your charging system. And I think most of us in the room have probably encountered a situation where we run into trouble with electrical systems, and we probably know that 2,000 watts in most cars is probably not a good idea. So you are setting yourself up for failure. Either the customer's performance expectations are not going to be met. They're certainly not going to be confident that they bought the right equipment from the right people if you just keep adding power, trying to get it loud, and all you're getting is 3 dB. That's it. So we got to be careful about some of these myths. Have we heard this one before, though? I think a lot of customers tell us this one more than anything else.
And while some of this may be obvious, you know, what we're trying to show you is things that you can tell the customer to help, instead of just saying, no, that doesn't work, and it's in their head that they got to have this much power because they saw it at some DB drag competition or they heard it from their buddy. But we're trying to give you information of how to overcome that with a customer. But by saying they want to double the power to their speaker, they're telling you they want a loud system. Remember, we can do loud. We have an array of product to choose from. we have solutions of different enclosure design, and that's how you should go to get loud. Doubling power is not how you want to get loud. And ultimately, there are shops where a customer comes in and says, I want to double the power, and they'll sell the amplifier because they want to make the sale, and eventually that customer is going to come back. We may lose them to the industry because now they've had a bad experience. So sometimes it just may be better to turn the customer away if they're dead set on this. You don't want to sell this. It doesn't make sense.
How many? Yeah.
If I have a customer walk in my store and want to buy another amplifier to drive their system, of course I want to explain all of this, but I'm going to make a sale. And if I have to, no matter what, I'm not going to let that customer walk, because in today's economy, I feel like, you know, this is like the 30s economy, only it's 2011. You know what I'm saying? And I can't afford to let a customer walk out the door.
Right.
So I'm going to do whatever it takes, short of giving him a bad experience, you know, to get that billfold out of his pocket and give me some money.
Sure, I definitely understand where you're coming from. For those that didn't hear, your concern is that you don't want to tell a customer no to a sale because the economy really doesn't allow us to turn away any business at all. The only concern I would have is if the customer buys it from you and has an expectation that it's going to work well for him, he's setting himself up for a disappointment and a potential long-term problem. Pardon the analogy, but it's like getting involved with a woman you don't really love and then marrying her. You kind of got involved in something that you probably shouldn't have been in the first place, and in the end, it's going to cost you a lot of money.
And ultimately, we talk about why we want to have good demo systems, and this is why, because when you explain to the customer this is a bad situation, then you can go prove them wrong by doing a good demo in your car or your store's demo vehicle to show them what loud is and help meet those expectations.
He had something else to add. Yeah. And what's great about that, actually, what he's saying is the shop down the road is going to sell him something or tell him something completely different than what we might tell him. When the customer has a problem with a system that's been poorly set up by not understanding what's going on with this stuff, it's going to be a problem and the customer is going to be unhappy. And I haven't done perfect math on this, but you pretty much got one shot. You make a sale. If the system fails for any reason, a woofer blows, an amplifier fails, and a charging system has a problem, you have one opportunity to make it right before you lose any profitability that you may have already had. So if you know that, you get that one chance to make it right. The second time, you're losing money. We know that systems like this ultimately are going to have at least one problem. Can Billy Bob's shop down the road fix it? Probably not, if they sold it to them in the first place. So it is sort of a longer road to success, and I know it's a difficult time to be, you know, saying things like this, but if a customer comes in insisting on a system that we know is going to fail, it may be more cost-effective and profitable in the long run for you to say, no, I'm not going to sell you a system that's going to fail.
I'm not telling the truth.
Yeah, no, at least right. You set the stage so when it
right.
does fail, he can go, man, the guy told me this was going to happen.
Right.
As opposed to...
So when Billy Bob says, I can make that work, and it doesn't, he's like, well, you know, Rob up the street, he said it would never work, and he was right. I'm going to go give him a shot. Maybe not always, I know, we need to be the shops that customers come to get quality audio that's reliable. Remember all the things that we spoke about yesterday, what our customers are looking for. Performance that meets or exceeds expectations, something that's reliable, confidence that they're buying from the right people, they're getting good service, and ultimately value for all their money. And if we want to do that for our customers to earn that profitability and business growth that we speak of, the only way we can do that is by selling systems that will do all of those things. Even if it means just telling the customer straight up, I could sell you that, it's going to have a problem, and I don't want you to have problems. When you buy from me, I want you to have confidence that you're buying something that's going to work long term. There's lots of shops. The guy down the road, I'm willing to bet, he's going to go ahead and sell you exactly what you want, and you're going to have a problem. Tell you what, when you do have a problem, come to me, and I'll find a way to make it right. Something along those lines. Understand the message and not necessarily the wording of what I'm trying to share with you. That if we're upstanding, reputable, and know what we're talking about and convey that to our customers, in the long run, our industry will, all of us will elevate, and that's a good thing for everyone. Sorry. All right, the next one we got up there. I like this one. How many have done something like this? Don't worry. I know the sub's rated for 500 watts, 1,000 watt amps, but I'll put the gain at halfway. 1,000 watts halfway, it's only 500 watts, right?
Why don't we turn it up that loud?
Or the best thing is when a customer gets the system and his friend says, oh, dude, they're ripping you off. That leveled control is way down low. Let me turn that up and it'll get louder. And what happens when they do? It does get louder. Absolutely gets louder because maybe they're not at the top end of the volume yet. Maybe they're playing a track that's not quite reaching clipping. But we all know what's eventually going to happen. This is a real dangerous thing. Yesterday we touched on how to set levels appropriately using that that CD with the test tones and all that. The guys that have O-scopes, you can look at the waveform if you want to on the output. These are much better ways of doing things. One thing, I don't know if I shared it yesterday, about using the voltage level setting procedure that we outlined yesterday. What I like about it is it's repeatable. As opposed to the, you know, the guy in the shop that's got the golden ears that always tunes the system and sets the levels just perfectly. Or, of course, the trick of using hot glue to cover the input sensitivity and when it's missing. You know, I know these things. I've heard them. But what I like about the level setting procedure with the voltage is if you set the voltage on the output of the amplifier, that's the voltage. Customer comes back. If you put the same track in at the same volume position and you measure a different voltage, someone messed with your dial. Again, what's that? Absolutely. And what I like about this method is if the customer comes in with a blown woofer and they've messed with the input sensitivity control, you take your meter, you put it out there, see what happened here? I'm willing to bet maybe you or one of your friends thought maybe you could get a little bit more performance out of the system. You probably adjusted it, and the customer's going to lie. We talked about that. They're probably going to lie to you. And so, well, see, what we did when we set up your system, we calculated out how much power the amplifier is capable of without having a problem. And the number was, 34.7 or whatever the number was yesterday. That's what it was set at. Now it's reading 80. Someone's changed this dial and has now made the system unreliable. What we're going to do is we're going to reset it now, and we're going to put it back where it was. We'll replace the woofer, but if it happens again and it's different, I'm going to have to charge it for the warranty, as opposed to saying, dude, you messed with it.
Well, and if the guy says, but it's not loud enough, what do? Sell him more.
Send him to the guy at the road. No, kidding.
then maybe the customers will stop coming in and saying, hey, can you turn my amp up? It's not loud.
The thing about you make, I know you're sort of kidding about manufacturers putting a this is not a volume control on there. The amps are getting smaller, so we don't have enough room. What the reality is, a lot of manufacturers that are less worried about your growth and potential, they don't want customers to know the truth about what's going on. They just want to put big numbers on the side of a box, or they don't care. And I'm not saying we're the only ones that do it. There's lots of really good manufacturers out there that care about the quality of the equipment they sell and want to give really good information. Those are the ones that you're probably doing business with anyway, so you probably have a better opportunity to get the product that you're looking for and do the setup. And we can't save the world from bad sound, but we're sure trying.
But the amps are really huge heat sinks. You have all real estate, and the customers would love it
because
the amps
are
really big.
It's interesting.
Yeah, huge and useless.
I like that. You had a question.
What about including a sticker in the box for dealers, or giving dealers stickers that say, you know, the ones that you pull off, warranty void if removed, and putting that over the gain control?
So give our dealers or installers an opportunity to put that on there? That's an interesting idea. Yeah, I wonder if that could be done.
You can buy those decals and staples too.
There you go. That was easy. Excellent input, gang.
Oh, this is a good one. So you're not getting your money's worth if you don't have enough power to reach the woofer's excursion limits. We actually heard this a lot when we started shipping the W7 because people saw this great woofer that has the potential to do a lot of excursion. They just assume that, you know, you got to have an amplifier to be able to move it from peak to peak. Why is that bad? When do you actually want the speaker to travel full peak to peak? Yeah, on the transient. So if you look at the waveforms that Steve showed yesterday, at the peaks of the music, that's when it's asking the speaker to move that far. So think of the other analogy. If you have like a Baja racer, you guys seen those Baja racers? They got huge suspension systems. Now, that's so when they hit a huge pothole in the track that the vehicle's able to survive it. But do they drive around the track trying to max out the suspension everywhere? We laugh, but there's people that have these perceptions. Or the analogy I use is when you get in your car, do you just redline it everywhere you go? No, you don't. It's there when you need it. So, Some people do that. But you're not really trying to max out the woofer all the time. So it's just, it's a very bad myth that's out there. But if the customer's saying this, what are they really telling you?
They want more.
They want loud. We
so can
you we can do that.
Excursion with less than rated power?
Yes.
Yeah.
When you're dealing with a subwoofer, we spoke yesterday about the difference between AC and DC, and DC is easy because whatever it is what it is. So when you measure resistance in DC, it's pretty much a fixed value, pretty much. But with AC, it's an impedance curve, and there's going to be peaks in the impedance curve such that at the resonant point of a given system, the actual impedance is going to be very, very high. It could be like 80 or 90 ohms, which sounds ridiculous, but the speaker still plays really, really loud. Think of a bell. When you hit a bell, it's not moving a whole lot, but it's really loud at a particular frequency. So it's actually, it's an interesting relationship. So you don't need tons of power to drive a speaker to peak excursion at certain frequencies. At other frequencies, yeah, you do. But at certain frequencies, like especially at very low frequencies, you could get that thing moving at well under rated power. You know, a ported box, it becomes unloaded, things like that. So where this, I think, really started coming from was when SPL got really, really popular. Like hugely popular about 10 years or so ago, and people realized that to make output, as you know, a lot of output, you need excursion and piston area. And you saw a lot of speakers coming with gigantic, you know, surrounds to allow for great excursion, but the piston area kept getting smaller. Manufacturer came up with ideas of, you know, we came up with the overall surround on the W7. Stewart Designs came out with a square frame woofer to increase the piston area and had high excursion to get it loud. So then the SPL guy said, wow, if you have bigger piston area and you can make it go to full excursion, you can get maximum output. Well, they're technically right, but that's a one-note wonder. That's just a one-shot deal. If you're selling this every day to your regular customers, that is a recipe for disaster. We don't want that. We want the ability on tap, like Jason said, to be able to get those transient peaks to be reproduced accurately. And yeah, if you get to the woofer's excursion, that's what it's there for. Use it when you need it. But you don't want to be there all the time. You don't want that much power. Really, you don't, because you'll kill things. What's next, Jay?
This is a really good one. Big woofers need more power than small ones to get loud. How many people have seen this one? You got a 15. You got to have more power. The reason it's wrong, taking efficiency out of the equation, if you have a 15-inch sub and a 10-inch sub, essentially, between most manufacturers, the only difference is the size of the cone. Not many of them actually change the size of the voice coil. But if you have 200 watts to both of them, which one's going to be louder? Well, the 15, because it's more cone area. So that's why this myth is wrong. Now, obviously, what it leads to is if the guy's got too little power to the speaker, it goes back to that other myth. But like Joey was pointing out, they may max out the system and cause problems. But if a guy comes in and he's got a set amount of power and he wants to get loud, sell him the bigger woofer. The coil's going to be larger in some cases, so it's going to handle a little bit of the extra abuse, and it's going to play louder because it's a bigger cone.
Yeah, this is a popular one. You know, people see big 15s and they say you need a ton of power to drive it. Now, Jason kind of touched on it. All things being generally equal, that would just not be true. We spoke yesterday about doubling piston area and you got 3 dB. As you go from an 8 to a 15, you're more than doubling it. So watt per watt, the 15 will always be louder. And Jason sort of touched on efficiency. Bigger speakers are going to be more efficient. And speaking of that, how efficient are subwoofers? In terms of a percentage, you know, if you put 100 watts into a speaker, how much of that percentage-wise turns into actual sound? Yeah. Oh, I think you're talking dBSPL. I'm talking percentage. Is it like, you know, 50%? Who thinks it's around 50%? About half of it's wasted as heat? Maybe 25% or 75% is wasted as heat, somewhere around there? No, not even close. What about like 10% or 90% of its wasted heat? That's ridiculous, right? Well, it's worse than that. Most of the subwoofers that you're likely to encounter in our industry are about 1% efficient. Meaning, when you put 100 watts into that voice coil, 99 of those watts are creating heat. The rest of it's making sound. Now, high-frequency drivers, like the ones that are in that speaker over there, they tend to be a bit more efficient. But how much more? Horn-loaded drivers can be upwards around maybe 5%. Still an enormous amount of inefficiency in these drivers. And a lot of it's wasted as heat. So what we're talking about here, about what's killing speakers, loudspeaker power handling, it's heat over time. And knowing how inefficient they are, you start to figure out why it gets a little dangerous when you start dumping excess power in there, because more and more actual watts are being wasted as heat. And this, I think, led into a lot of that. This is something about ours, but have you ever heard people say that woofer is way underrated? I know you could put a lot more power into it and still make it play well. I know when I was in retail, I used to say that exact statement I would say all the time. Because with experience, you know that you can probably eke out a little bit more in most cases, but I caution you this. Our customers are not us. Our customers don't understand limitations very often. They don't get that there's an end to everything. We kind of get it, and of course we also have a warehouse filled with inventory. We often forget that our customers are going to push things up to their limit and beyond because they don't really know the consequences until something breaks. Now, maybe I'm working with you, Spike, and I'm setting you up with the system. I'll tell you, yeah, go ahead and put a lot more power on that. Just be careful when you turn it up. You and I have a relationship. We go way back. If you blow it up, you can say, damn, sorry. But our customers are going to be far less understanding about blowing up really expensive gear. So we need to know that if this woofer is capable of that, we need to be very careful with how we present that to customers. One thing that we've done as a company is we tried to give our dealers a range of power recommendations that can make some sense. And it's almost counterintuitive to a lot of people. If you have a customer that's trying to extract maximum performance out of something, very often they'll do like I was saying to you, go ahead and put more power on it. But unfortunately, customers that are trying to extract more performance out of a system are likely to be abusers. So you want to run away from the higher power. You want to actually put a lot less power, knowing, of course, that too little power doesn't blow speakers. If you set it up right, you can actually have a much more reliable system. So instead of adding power to try to get that excess performance, what's another way that we can gain output without adding power? We could alter the enclosure type of going from sealed to a ported or to a bandpass or some of the other designs can gain some efficiencies back, or sell another woofer. Selling another woofer, let's say you have a 1,000-watt amplifier and you want it to be a bit louder, so you change the port to a ported box, you gain some output that way. He still wants more, so you sell him a bigger amplifier.
Keep in mind that music plays a very important role, which we're going to touch on a little bit, but if you remember the last demo we left with yesterday, that music with a high crest factor of 20 dB, how much power did Steve say if it was 1,000 watts was actually going to the sub or speakers? It was 10. So in that situation, a customer listening to that type of music, you can obviously overpower. You could run 2/8 off 1,000 watts. And we've probably seen that scenario where a customer had, you know, way more power than what's recommended. They just wanted it there if they needed it. But that's because with the music they're listening to, the average power going to the speaker was very minimal. Right. But we're going to show you in a little bit how other types of music is a lot different than that, and then you run into problems.
Want to touch on the failures?
Yeah, so you have two different types of failures when it comes to speakers. You have physical failures where speakers reach their physical limits, and then you have thermal limits, which we have some fine examples of that up here. But whenever you have a physical failure, we're talking about torn surrounds, ripped or fatigued spiders, broken tensile leads, glue joint failures. You guys have seen that before. If you're a JL dealer, you've probably been through trainings where we've done a lot of things to re-engineer the product so that those things don't happen. But as long as you have good product, this shouldn't be happening. But if this is happening, it's usually related to poor enclosure design or a poorly built enclosure. You should always follow specs and recommendations. I was at a dealer once, and you'll laugh, but this was a good dealer, but I said, where'd you come up with that design for that woofer? Well, I can look at a speaker and tell what it needs. Wow.
Just by looking at it. Amazing.
You built it differently than what we recommend.
He's in car audio. What do you think?
I can't speak for other companies, but if you're in the product training yesterday, and Steve did a great job talking about Lucio does a lot of testing. We just don't say, you know, here's the spec of that woofer because, you know, we just throw it down there. There's a lot of extensive testing that goes on with that. Can you change the enclosure design? Yeah, absolutely. Depending on what the customer wants. Maybe he doesn't have quite enough power. You can make the box a little bit bigger for efficiency and things like that. But yeah, poor enclosure design or a poorly built enclosure will lead to failures such as this.
One thing that's interesting is a story I like to tell. When I first started doing training for the company I work for, one of our strong competitors remains that way today is Stillwater Kicker. They make really good product. And back then, their product, the Solo Barracks, you probably remember them. You know, the old guys. I'm looking around for old guys. So the old guys, we had W6s. They had, you know, the Solo Barracks. The Solo Barracks were recommended in one specific sealed box. That was it. And we, of course, had a range of enclosures and ported volume, so that was a big selling point. And one day it hit me, they're brilliant. They're so smart because they eliminate a lot of this issue by just saying, build this box or else. although it limits us in terms of what we're able to do with the product, in terms of failures, they really managed it quite well. And it's exactly what Jason's saying. The enclosure design and construction and all that will play a big part in the speaker's power handling in terms of mechanics. Now, thermally, it's a little bit different than that. Thermal things are burnt stuff, like delaminated coils, like the one there. We call that slinky. You can probably imagine why. burnt lead wires, and I'm not talking from when they touch each other, which is a really bad thing, but like burnt lead wires because the resistance of the lead wire is too high and it causes, you know, a failure. And the separation of the voice coil former from the cone. This is a neck joint failure, which is similar to some of the things that Jason was saying. Traditional way a speaker is built is, imagine you have a cone that comes down, and then you have the voice coil former that kind of comes underneath, and then the spider attaches at that same point. The glue that's used to hold all those components together is heat sensitive. So as the coil gets hot, that heat travels up to the neck joint and melts the glue. And when the glue breaks, what you wind up with is, I've seen it where the coil and the spider are together, but they're slapping up against the bottom of the cone. Have you seen that? Or how about when the spider just stays there and the cone and voice coil move up and down, but the spider doesn't move at all? These are all versions of a neck joint failure, and it's usually related to a heat buildup at that neck. You know, Jason mentioned there's some technologies that companies are coming out with to try to prevent that, because it is one of the most popular reasons for speakers to fail. What is the most popular reasons for them to fail?
It's between the seat and the steering wheel.
Exactly, yes. It's between the seat and the steering wheel, but it's a burnt voice coil. It's to the point now, this is a little funny aside, when we get our RA requests in, everything burnt coil. Burnt coil, blown, everything. A lot of times it's not. You know, they've torn the surround somehow or some other failures, but it's just burnt, because it is that common. So anyway, sorry. Do we have tracks to play on this one or no?
No, I've already surpassed them.
Okay, so everyone comfortable with the loudspeaker panel power handling stuff that we've talked about? Any questions on what we've covered?
So what blows speakers?
Customers.
Heat.
So none of us have ever blown a speaker, right? Average power over time. An increase in average power time, a buildup of heat over time is what's going to burn up subwoofers, period. That's it. Barring any manufacturing defect.
It's funny that we get calls and dealers will say, I got this customer, he's blown three speakers. They say, congratulations, you figured out it's not the speaker. There's something else going on in the system. What's that? Anchors. Don't drop your anchor under speaker.
We touched on this yesterday, so just to do a quick recap. The top is a square wave and the bottom is a sine wave. We're going to start getting into the role that music plays in the performance and reliability of an audio system. So we're going to play some music. We got some other stuff we're going to do. But as a reminder, what's the crest factor, the difference between the peak and average power? What's the crest factor of a square wave? Who's that? Crest factor of a square wave is zero because the peak and average are the same. It goes all on all the time. Very damaging. You probably know this. You probably heard this. Stay away from square waves. Sine waves are not much better. The crest factor of a sine wave, difference between peak and average on a sine wave is, who remembers? It's half power. Half power would be a crest factor of 3 dB. So in this, you know, I like my 1,000 watt example because the math is easy. So if it's a 1,000 watt amplifier on the top, you're getting 1,000 watts all the time. If it's a 1,000-watt amplifier on the bottom, you're getting 500 watts all the time. That amp should be rated as a 500-watt amplifier because that's the effective power that you're using. The effective or average power over time would be 500 watts. So my 1,000-watt example is flawed in that regard. But I don't want to listen to sine waves anymore. I want to listen to music. So how many tracks do we want to do?
I don't know. We'll just kind of see how it goes.
I got a lot more music than you guys probably want to hear. You'll see as we go forward. But I'll tell you this, we have some tracks that we really want to focus on, so we're going to play those. We'll also put slides up, and you can look in the book to see if there's any track that you really want to hear. But don't look ahead, because I'm still talking. I want to describe to you what you have up here on the board. What page number are we on, in case you have trouble seeing this? We're on page 29 in the handout. All right, upper left-hand corner, we're going to indicate what decade the recording was done in, who the artist is, the title of the track, and what the crest factor is. This one is huge. It's crest factor of just over 20. Upper right-hand corner is a spectral analysis, which is basically if you used an RTA and sampled the recording over time, that's the amount of energy you get per frequency. Low frequencies on the left, high frequencies on the right. The scaling, you got the 0 dB line, the heavy line in the center. As you go up, the first solid line that you see is plus 20 dB. Minus 20 dB is underneath that, of course. So that kind of gives you an idea of the scaling. So this particular recording is pretty even energy across a very wide spectrum. the lower two graphs. The top one is a wide time sample of the track as seen through an analysis program. We use a program called Amadeus Pro for the Mac. If you're interested in it, it's like $20 or something like that. So what you're looking at there, remember yesterday we played the snare drum and we identified the attack and then the decay, and we were able to look into the waveform and kind of see what was going on. Well, if you look at this, again, you'll see there's certain points of attack. You can probably imagine what those points are. Usually drum strikes, a lot of quick energy. So you see the spikes as you go from left to right. Also notice the amount of black energy. Black is power. Black is also heat. So the more black you see, the more power you see, and the more heat the voice coil is likely to see. Also, the more power the amplifier will draw from the charging system. The peak to the average, if you look, kind of visualize it in your mind, from the peak of those spikes to the average of the black area, that difference is the 20 dB that we're talking about. If you want to drill down a little bit closer in terms of time, we just zoomed in on it on the bottom graph, and you can kind of see some of the wave behavior for the low frequencies, and you can kind of see what the detail and resolution would be like in that the larger black area from the top chart. Everyone see where we're coming from with that? So what we're going to do is we're going to play this track. I want you to listen for the instruments, listen for the attack, the decay, all the things that we spoke of yesterday. I had done a check yesterday to make sure the people in the back could pick up on these details. They said they could, so if you can't, the people yesterday lied.
Now keep in mind that the whole point of this music demonstration is to actually show the effect of speaker power handling and the effects of that it can have on the system. So we're going to play a lot of different stuff. This beginning couple of tracks is more to set the stage of what a very good dynamic recording sounds like. So if you're sitting there going, yeah, this is fine, but my customers don't listen to this.
We know.
We're going to get to that. We know that. The main goal is to understand how music's recorded and the effect it has on the audio system.
All right. You ready? Please. What'd you think? Sounded good. You could identify the instruments pretty clearly. Wasn't very loud, though. How would you make it louder? Turn the volume up, of course. You control the volume.
All knobs to the right.
All knobs to the right. What happens if you're already up all the way? How do you make it louder? Well, that's what we're here for. We sell bigger amplifiers if we can do it. We sell more speakers if we can do it. There's ways of getting additional output. But in terms of the recording itself, it's max. That's the way the recording was done. The peak to average energy is a 20 dB difference. Using that 1,000 watt example, you're getting about 10 watts of power. Again, if you're not clipping, you're not trying. You need to clip that one because it just isn't loud enough. Even if we clipped it by about 12 dB, it's still going to sound pretty darn good, and you get a lot more dynamic energy out of the system. So keep that in mind as we go forward. Anyone want to hear this one? Do we want to do this one? This is a little bit different. Check out the spectral energy. Crest factor is slightly better, so let's see how loud this one is.
I'm going down, Louisiana. Gonna give me a mojo, yeah. I'm gonna have all of you with me. Right on the mountain, man.
What did you think of that? Much different sound. The spectral energy is a lot different where the energy is actually being concentrated. Also notice there's no real clear peaks in that whole thing. There's just bursts of him when he sings really powerfully. But there's no easily identifiable peak. Some recordings, guys, some recordings are set up so that the entire recording, not each track, is optimized. So when you listen to it, I'm a big Pink Floyd fan. How many Floyd fans we got? All right, so you know what I'm talking about. When the album is mastered as one complete piece of music, and we happen to break it up into tracks and play it on the radio, but when you listen to these recordings, the peak of the actual recording might be on a different track. So the average energy across the entire recording is going to be lower than you might expect, and that's a good example of it here. There's a couple others that we'll come across. But again, if you want this louder, you either need more power, more speakers, or if you can, turn the volume up. But ultimately, the recording is somewhat fixed in that regard. What else we got, Jay? Which one we want to play? Oh, we got to play this one. I think I asked you to use the Pink Panther as one of the tracks. That's why I like to play this one. It's got a crest factor of almost 24. So the average energy is among the lowest, if you want to look at it that way, of everything that we've played so far. And again, the peak on this is somewhere else on the recording. So let's go ahead and check out the spectral energy and hit the Pink Panther.
Uh-huh.
Was that louder or quieter than the previous track? It was a little bit quieter. If you notice the difference in crest factor, it's actually went up by about 3 dB. So it was about 3 dB quieter.
It also draws a lot less power from the charging system as a result. There's just not a whole lot of energy in that particular track. So that's our reference. We're going to go off of that. Now we're going to play music from different genres, different decades. So we're going to get a little old on you first. So we're going to play a group. I'm not sure if you guys have ever heard of this group. It's the Beatles. You might be familiar with them. Obviously, they had a pretty special sound and they did pretty well. But what's the first thing you notice when I change the slides? Like if you go from this and then you change to that. It's a lot more black in that graph on the bottom, right? And if you look at the crest factor, it's a 10 dB difference compared to what we just played. So before I keep talking, let's go ahead and play that so you can see what that change sounds like. You might have heard this song too. Was it louder? Quite a bit. I'd say about, 10 dB louder, because the average energy has increased by 10 dB. So it's 10 times more power now than what you just heard before with the Pink Panther. We didn't change the volume control. That's a change in the recording process itself, which is fine. That still sounded good. Everyone knows the song. There's no real problem with that. But it also, and this is what's important for us to remember, it has a big impact on how we sell and how we set up a system. Because if you ran that first track, the Pink Panther track, if you ran that into clipping, and then you play this, this is clipping a lot more, because the difference between the peak and average are a lot closer. So you have a lot more average power going through the voice coil, and you have a hell of a lot more current draw from the system, because you're literally pulling 10 times the power from the amp and the charging system. So this is what we want to get on. It has nothing really to do with the music other than its contribution to the performance and reliability of the stuff we're selling our customers.
Which is why it's important you set the gains up with test tones, because I know some shops, there'll be a guy who sets the gains and he'll use his music. And then you give the car to the customer who uses different music and you'll run into problems because all the music's recorded differently. So it's better to use test tone so you have a blank slate.
Absolutely. So I guess now we just start asking you guys. Van Morrison, Brown Eyed Girl, who wants to hear it? Show of hands, who wants to hear this one? No? I heard some people said just play it. I only had a couple of hands. We playing it, Jay, or?
Yep.
Ooh, I skipped one. We doing? Wow, it's different. We just rolling or you stopping? So we jumped into the 70s kind of quick. We just wanted to get some things out there. You heard a big change from some of those when you went to Santana. It was a lot louder. You saw a lot more black. It's a bit more of a raw, edgy song from some of the other ones. Personally, I love the Stevie Wonder track. I think that sounds really good, nice and dynamic, excellent sound. We're going to play another track here. Do you want to play this? This kind of big band, not big band, like a jazz band kind of thing. Play this one. Love it. Pause it there. All right, so that's the old stuff. We're going to start, well, we're still going to play some old stuff. We're going to get into the 80s, but something changed in the 80s. What happened in the 80s? What's that? Synthesizers became a lot more common. We did have them earlier, but it wasn't as popular. But in terms of recording process, we had that shiny round thing instead of those old things with the magnetic tape strips in it, right? The CD came out, and what the CD offered, remember we talked about dynamic range? So CD offered a significant improvement in dynamic range. So if you think about it, like, you got the zero reference and then you got the ceiling. What CD did was it pushed the ceiling really high so we could put a lot more dynamic content into a recording. The ceiling got higher, and it was great because we could really open up the recording, get really good detail and resolution, better than pretty much any format that we had previously. And the initial recordings took full advantage of that, but things have changed. So we're going to play, we have to play Dire Straits, because everyone loves Dire Straits. If you don't love Dire Straits, I'm sorry, we got to play it anyway. But check out the crest factor on this mainstream, very popular recording. Go ahead, Jay. What was wrong with that? What? It wasn't loud enough. You're damn right it wasn't loud enough. I wanted to just grab the volume and crank it up because I like the song and I want it louder. It's just not loud enough. I either need more room on my volume control, more power on more speakers. But by trying to beat the hell out of things, we're going to run into problems. So that's where our job is, to make sure we sell enough to make it loud enough. Performance that exceeds expectations. We need to know what's going on with this. This particular track is the first thing that I've ever blown a pair of speakers on, because I wanted it louder, so I went and I found the volume control in the amplifier, you know, and I turned it up, and guess what, it got louder, and when I got to work, there was this lovely smell in my vehicle, and I didn't have sound anymore, but boy, it was a great ride in. So, was there a question? Yeah.
What was Andy's response?
Actually, it was before I worked, at JL, I was still working in retail at Speaker Warehouse. So the first thing I did was swapped out the bandpass box because I didn't hear the speaker saying, "Help!" It died. The door speakers died. So yeah. But hey, you know what? I like the song. I wanted it louder. I didn't have the power. I beat the hell out of it. But that's reality. That's what customers are going to do. We need to make sure that we sell into that so people like me don't keep coming into your store with blown equipment. Because I'm going to lie. I'm not going to tell you what I really did. You know. But I love that track, and I agree, Rob, that we need it louder. So, Talking Heads, who likes Talking Heads? We'll play this and we'll just play through a couple of tracks, and these are, you know, early 80s and mid 80s recordings. Crest factor here is huge. Little Run DMC. Pause after this. That's pretty interesting, wasn't it? Well, we could be here all day listening to this stuff. Crest factor is gigantic to 20 dB. That's huge if you really think about it. You can actually tell the synthesized instruments and what they sound like because they do a really good job of that. What I think is particularly interesting is the spectral plot. You know, rap music is supposed to have a lot of bass. It doesn't. The bass is actually not really there. They put an artificial peak up in the upper end to make it seem like there's a lot of energy. Recording processes often do things like this, where they put energy where people want it. And what's going to be really obvious as we go forward, that shift of energy can have a big difference on what we're selling. Subwoofers can tolerate a lot more abuse than a mid-range or high-frequency driver. So if you have a recording with a low crest factor with a lot of energy in the mid-range or high-frequency, that is more likely to blow those speakers and be audible to your customer than if it, let's say, was maybe perhaps a bass track that has lots of energy in a low frequency where our hearing can't pick up on the speaker screaming for help. But you'll see a couple of examples on that, but I wanted to pause on that one and mention that. All right, so now we're going to get into the 90s, and of course everyone should know Nirvana. And what was special about Nirvana when they hit the scene? What style of music was this?
Plaid.
It was what?
Plaid.
Plaid, it was very popular. But the grunge scene. the grunge scene, the style of music of grunge was, it was a harder edge, something with a rougher sound to it. It wasn't about detail and resolution, it was about having some of that, that hardness to it. And you can see there's a change in the crest factor, and you'll hear it in the recording. Listen to the instruments and how it sounds slightly different than some of the things we've already played. Jason, you mind hitting that? You can almost feel the tightness of how close the peaks and the averages were. The peak on this, again, is at a different part of the track, because you notice it's not much higher than the averages on that. So you can kind of hear the difference between that and even like the Run DMC or the Dire Straits one, where there was a much more dynamic range to it. But that was intentional. That was a style that they were looking for, and it worked. You know, grunge was wildly popular as a result. And we're going to get into some other stuff. If you want to play Chili Peppers, please. Edit. Edit. Had to edit. Yeah. Don't do it. A little country music for you. Awesome. That's about the end. If you like high crest factor, I don't have good news for you. From here on in, it doesn't get much better than what you just heard. I'm just going to hit the slide and you'll see what I'm talking about.
Was that Amadeus Pro you said?
Yeah, Amadeus Pro. I think I have it on this computer later if you want to check it out. So here's Metallica. And just for the record, I really like this stuff. It's not that we're picking on the music. It has nothing to do with the style of music. It has everything to do with the quality and reliability of what we're selling our customers. This track with a crest factor of 9 is going to be a hell of a lot more demanding than that Brooks and Dunn with a crest factor of 17. It's a huge difference in terms of current draw, huge difference in terms of heat through the voice coil. When you see black, think heat. So we have to play this just to give you a sample of what this is like. But before we do, there's a couple of things about the spectral plot, sorry, the waveform behavior that I want you to look at down here. Look at this. What's happening here? It's already clipped. The signal has already been clipped on the recording itself, so when you play it back, even if you set everything perfectly so that it never clips, it's already clipped. So that adds an additional layer of confusion for you when you start thinking about things, because now the signal's already in trouble before you've even gotten to it. As a side note, the most recent Metallica recording that came out, what's the name of that one? The Death Magnetic or something like that, right? When that recording came out, they met with so much resistance from the buying public on the CD that they actually recalled the original CDs and reissued it with a different mastering. And the reason for that is Rock Band. You know the game Rock Band for the consoles? The Rock Band recording version of that CD was significantly better than the actual CD itself. So what people were doing, check this out. Check out how smart your customers actually are. They were buying the Rock Band game, setting it on easy, and recording the output and burning it to a CD so it sounded better. Because they wanted it to sound better. They didn't like the fact that it was just loud and had no clarity to it. So let's go ahead and play what I mean by this. Wow, that'll wake you up in the morning, huh? The song rocks. It's a fun, fun song. It's easily loud enough, you know, compared to our Dire Straits example from earlier. But what if you want it louder? Clip that? Ooh, careful. because your peaks and averages are really close together. Even minor clipping on that could be pretty bad. We'll do an example of that a little bit later. So now as we get into the 2000s, we go into Godsmack. Personally, one of my favorite groups. I know you wouldn't guess that, but but again, we have the blur of information. It's a crest factor of 9.7. Spectral energy is interesting, if you look at where the energy is. We're going to go through a couple of different tracks here. We'll go through them kind of quick, so you can kind of get a feel for what we're talking about. Listen to the detail in the instruments, if you can, and just hear the changes, and we'll pause it at a couple of spots. Here's Evanescence. Listen to this one. When you saw the slide come up with all the black, did you think it would be a little louder than it actually was? Where's the energy? Look at the spectral plot. What's that? In that regard, they probably did. But the most important thing I want to focus on with that is the energy is actually shifted to that lower portion. Remember yesterday we talked about the range of human hearing and how the first two octaves were for bass, and the other eight octaves were for mids and highs. What we've really focused on so far has been that other eight octaves. The differences that you've heard have really taken place in that area. When you have something like bass mechanic or other bass-heavy information, it's putting most of that energy down in those lower two octaves. Half of the energy content of what we hear is already there, and now they're boosting it. If you remember, that first line up is plus 20 dB. So you've got about a 15 to 18 dB boost in low frequency alone. This is not surprising to you. You already knew this. But if you focused in on the mids and highs on that track, it sounded fine. What's having trouble is the subwoofer section. The bass amplifier and a subwoofer are getting beat to hell. You don't notice it because your ear is not as sensitive to it. But because the mids and highs are pleasing, our customers have a tendency to want to keep turning it up and up and up, and that's where the failures start coming in. We need to know about this when we're setting up our systems. This is what's important. Look at the bottom one. You can actually see the bass note as almost as a sine wave. That's why the energy content's so high. Crest factor is 8. It's the lowest that you've heard so far, but it didn't sound bad again because it was all down in that lower frequency area. Interesting stuff, no? All right, so here's Linkin Park. You already got a sneak preview. We'll play this and keep going. Please? We can't see what track we're on. That's the problem. What's interesting, I just wanted to pause real quick because that's almost the same crest factor as bass mechanic, but I think that was far more aggressive because, again, the mids and highs is where the energy actually is and not in the low frequency. Now I'll shut up and keep going. Some Santana. This is a Grammy award-winning recording, by the way. The website? Show the website? The one with the graphic thing?
Go to the next one.
Look at the bass line. It's no doubt.
Love this one.
What'd you think of that? Kind of went through a bunch of different tracks. Yeah, I think you heard the differences between each recording style, what the energy shifts were, what the crest factors were. You probably had some trouble picking up some detail and resolution. But on that last track, I have something interesting to share with you. How many of us have children? Young kids? You ever hear those kids bop recordings? You know what these things are? For those that don't, kids bop recordings, they take popular songs like the one you just heard, and they remix it and play it both with kids singing. So it's more fun, and the kids can, you know, sing the popular songs along with other kids, you know? Well, we actually have a recording of kids bop doing this. And what's really shocking is, look at that, and now look at the kids bop version. The recording is completely different in terms of how it sounds. So let's go ahead and play this so you can hear the difference between a mainstream recording and one that's not so mainstream. I know it's a lot different, but you could actually hear the clarity in the instruments again. And it's the same real song, but now it just sounds better. I miss that. I mean, if I could get that, but have the, you know, the real singers involved with it, it'd be better. Earlier, we played Linkin Park. Now, I think Linkin Park's a fantastic band, and a lot of people in our trainings have pointed out, I've heard that song sound better. Where have you heard it sound better? Maybe live, in concert, or maybe on their DVD. Because the DVD, they're pulling it from the console. It's not actually being mixed down to play louder on the radio, which is the reason a lot of this is happening, because they're trying to compress it. If you guys don't mind, I want to break from the PowerPoint. A friend of mine over in England posted a video on his Facebook page, and it speaks into this really, really well, far better than I think even Jason and I could ever do. It'll just take me a minute to get there, so maybe you can do some filler for me while I do this.
You're not going to be able to play the audio, though.
A thinking man. I'll put my microphone to the computer, see if I can make that happen. Okay, so here we go.
Does anybody have any questions what we've covered so far?
Well, it'll get the point across.
A lot of times when we do this presentation, some people kind of get depressed because of the way music's recorded, and you could go down that road. But the whole point of the presentation is to understand that your customers are coming in listening to a lot of this, and they want a loud, reliable system. You need to understand the effects that the music has on that. Question. That could be another problem. Actually, Steve was over in England a couple months ago, and they had a customer, had a big JL system, and he was just complaining that it didn't sound good. So they went through, they tuned the gain, set crossover levels, did everything that Steve knows how to make a system sound good, and they were using the customer's iPod, and it still didn't quite sound good. And our rep over there said, I know this song, it should sound better. Grabbed his iPod, plugged it in. The customer was blown away. What did you do? Well, he had downloaded an MP3 from some file sharing service, and it was a bad recording. So that's where you need to actually educate your customers on the different recording processes. I've seen dealers actually train their customers how to use iTunes, which on one hand it's like, well, that's a bunch of time on something I'm not making money on, but you're educating them on the differences, because there are, you know, different types of recordings. Ironically, iTunes is now launching a new service to have better recordings. So people do want better sound. It is worth it to pay for the better file. You ready?
I think I am. Did it go away? Okay. All right, here we go.
Is damaging the sound quality of modern CDs. First, I'll play an example of a track from 1989. Notice the clarity and punch of the drums. Since the two drum hits are already maximum volume, if we we want the track louder on the recording, we have to take the quieter bits and turn them up. If this track had been released in 2006, someone would probably have insisted that it be this loud. Now it sounds much louder, and in the short term, louder can seem better. But you own the volume knob, not the record producer. So you adjust your volume to find your preferred level. Here we have the same volume as the original. Unfortunately, the loudness treatment permanently changes the sound. Do you notice what's missing? The red sections mark where the punch and clarity would have been. Let's hear what that maximized track sounds like at regular listening volume. Whippy, loud sound. All the punch of the drums is gone, along with much of the feel of the music that comes from some parts being louder than others. When there's no quiet, there can be no loud. The original makes you turn up your volume, and when you do, it sounds great.
What do you think of that? Says a lot, you know, the way they raised up that floor, and they did that whole change. It's a big deal, and you heard a major. I hope even through those crappy speakers, you heard a major difference in things. Hang on, let me just get back to where I was. Point. There we go. All right, let me get this out of here. What did Alan gotta exit? There we go. Back to the PowerPoint.
We got a couple more tracks?
Yes, we do. Okay, so that was Kids Bop, and then you heard the loudest war thing, which is a big deal. All right, so we're going to play Godsmack again, because I like it. But I want to show you, to wrap up this section, I want to show you why it's important to know about this stuff, especially when dealing with something like this. So as a reference, it's a crest factor of 9.7, so you're getting quite a bit of average energy. And again, like the guy said in the video, when there is no soft, there can be no loud. It's all loud. You heard it. So we're going to go ahead and play this as a reference. Go ahead and hit it. And now we're going to clip it by, what was it, 3 dB the first time, and then 6? Just by 3 dB. Remember yesterday we clipped by 12 dB, and you remember how you had no problem with it. But let's clip this by 3 dB. Please. Pretty noticeable even at that point. 6 dB.
Sounds like out front.
So you can see how, with a track like this, even minor clipping can lead to an increase of average power that's quite significant, and the sound obviously deteriorates very, very quickly. This is why it's important. We need to know what we're doing. We need to know what we're selling. We need to know how we're setting it up. Because the change in music, and Jason, I think you said something great earlier. If you tune it for a type of music that you find more pleasing, perhaps, or something that's recorded much better, like that ridiculous Michael Ruff track that we played to start this section off, our customers are not listening to that. So if that's what you're using to tune it, because it's a good recording that you can actually listen to in terms of the music and the instruments, when you play something like this, if you set it to clip a little bit with the other, a little bit on this becomes very damaging and abusive. And that's really what we need to be worried about. This loudness war is something that we have to deal with. We are fighting a battle, so to speak. And it's fine as long as we know what we're up against.
Keep in mind when we talk about tuning, that the very dynamic tracks are great for tuning in terms of equalization and crossover points. When Steve mentions tuning, he's mentioning setting the gain levels.
Right.
So those CDs are great for tuning the system for fidelity, but when it comes to setting gain levels, you should really be using an O-scope or a meter with test tones.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions on the music? Questions on crest factor? On anything we covered with the music? Again, it's more for you to understand the music's role in how it can affect speaker power handling. Yes?
I guess I'm going back.
That's okay.
They are using inferior music to blow their speakers.
Well, part of this has to happen in the beginning of the sale with qualification. I'm not that far out of retail. I know when you ask the customer, what do you listen to? Oh, I listen to everything. You really need to do a good job at drilling down, not only what type of music they listen to, but now you have to find out how they're listening to it. Are they listening to streaming music via their phone or MP3s? And just a simple conversation of, just so you know, I'm designing the system based on this. If you listen to these files or this, that, or the other thing, letting them know that that can cause problems down the road. So it's an extra step in the sales process. At least if then they blow the speakers, they're going to remember you told them that there might be problems down the road.
Did I answer that for you?
We understand that customers are more challenging these days because mm-hmm. we get tons of consumer phone calls, and sometimes they just won't listen to it. But at least if you've discussed it up front and you know you have systems you can demo to meet their expectations, you've done as much work as possible to prevent that from happening.
It also comes into play, though, too, like how many people really use CDs in the
world? Right.
I was recording, quite honestly, in the way so far.
Yeah.
Then again, I bought a CD of like Eagles High Definition, and it sounds phenomenal. They play the same track on their iPod at 128K.
Right. I would encourage that you still demo systems with that type of stuff because some customers nowadays, they were born into the iPod generation. They may not have heard of a really good Eagles recording track, and you'll educate them. We've done this training, you know, a bunch of times, and there's been, you know, guys that were newer in the industry that had never heard some of that music and wanted to know how they could go buy it and who the artists were and things like that. Leads me to a story. Manville and I were once at a dealer in Atlanta, and I will not tell who the dealer was, but there was a really good dealer, has a couple of stores, and then they said, yeah, well, I don't sell your TR product. I sell this other brand over it. I think it sounds better. Manville said, really? Can I hear it? Sure. Walks over to the display board, turns on XM radio, and turns it up. That's a horrible, horrible demo. I don't even care if that's what the customer's listening to. You should be doing the best demo possible. So Manville said, no. You know, can I plug in my iPhone? You have all these plugs up here. None of them worked. So that was a whole other issue. Finally, we got an iPod from the installer and back and plugged it in and played it. And he said, okay, now let's add some amplifier power. The board's not set up to do that. It's like, well, of course these other speakers are going to sound better. They're more efficient. You don't have amplifier power. But you should always be doing good demos. A great demo will beat a lot of these issues. Because a lot of people, customer comes in, I want to buy a system. You figure the customer's only got $500, so you sell into that, and then the customer comes back not happy. You always should do a good demo. That is the setup to making a great sale. I had a customer that came in once in retail, came from the shop I used to work at, and said, hey, they just gave me this quote for $2,000. Can you match that? And I said, well, yeah, but let's take a look at what you got. And we didn't sell the same products, but I had comparable products at the same price point. So I said, no, let me show you something first. And I played our best MB Court speakers with our JL subs, our PPI amps. It was about a $4,000 system. The guy's like, man, that does sound awesome, but you know, I'm really at this $2,000 budget. And I said, great, I just wanted to show you what's capable. And based on what you're telling me, I think this is what you want. But he wanted to spend $2,000. So I matched the price. We did the install. He came back a month later. Guess what? Wasn't what he wanted. Ripped it all out, sold the $4,000 system. Had I not set the stage with what he could get, that would have never happened. I would have matched the price. He probably would have been happy, but not as happy as what he wanted. So it's challenging. None of us have as much time these days, but that's what we have to do. That's what we sell. Yes?
You can never fall up a flight of stairs. Always start high or down low.
Yep.
Absolutely. The whole reason we're successful in home audio is because our first product was a $13,000 home subwoofer. We knew we weren't going to sell a lot of them, but that set the stage for the rest of the product. But we do actually sell quite a few.
Surprising number.
All right. Good questions, though, guys.
Really good.
All right. Let's talk about vehicle charging systems. We've got about 45 minutes left, so we've got to...
Yeah, we're doing good.
We got to
11:15.
So we got almost an hour. Cool.
So we've talked about Ohm's Law. We did some computing of math to show how Ohm's Law works. Steve spent some time on AC theory, electronics, waveforms,
magnets.
We talked about loudspeaker power handling. We talked about music. Now we're going to talk about charging system, and then we're going to talk about designing a system and look at those systems we talked about yesterday. So here we have the main components that make up an electrical system. What's the main source of power in a car?
Electricity.
alternator, not the battery. The alternator is what produces the power. The battery starts the car. After that, the alternator takes over and runs the system. We kind of broke it down where we show the alternator, the battery, and we have a couple of amplifiers. There's a couple of things you can do to actually beef up an electrical system in a vehicle. Say you're putting a real high draw system in a car. There's a couple things you can do. If you put a system in a car and you're having voltage issues, what do you do to fix that?
Check all your grounds.
Check all your grounds.
You sound like tech support now.
There's a couple things you can sell the customer. And again, these are things you should cover up front because there's nothing worse. Customer comes back, hey, my system's shutting down. Oh, you have to spend another X number of dollars to fix that. We should have told them that in the beginning. But there's a couple of things, and I'm just going to jot them down, then we'll talk about the order. You could add a battery. You could add or change the alternator. You could upgrade three wires. You could sell a cap. You never want to just jump to adding a battery. That creates an extra load. A lot of people think adding a battery is going to fix the voltage issue. It's not. You're putting an extra load on the alternator. The alternator is the main source of power in the car. What's the first thing you should do?
Upgrade the battery.
You can upgrade the battery ground. You can actually upgrade the battery as well. So take out the stock and, you know, you guys probably all saw better batteries. But upgrade the battery ground, or what we'll just call the three wires. The ground for the alternator, the ground for the battery, and the power wire going from the alternator to the battery. When the companies design these systems, they design them for the electrical components that are in there, and they don't give us much fudge factor for the stuff we're going to add in. If we put a 1,000-watt system in a car, how much current draw does that potentially have? Yeah, about. We can actually do the math because I taught you this yesterday. So 1,000 watts divided by 12. It's too early for me to do math in my head, so I'm hoping someone has a calculator.
No, I'm too lazy to get my phone. Come on, Micah, the math whiz.
83 amps. So potentially this can pull 83 amps, which we don't have that extra room in there. Our battery is our reserve tank and could probably handle it, but depending on what kind of music we're listening to, it could actually pull this all the time and then you lead to problems. But the three wires is what you should do first before anything, because if you do all these other things but you haven't upgraded these wires, it's not gonna help. Your upgrades aren't gonna matter. Let's look at pricing. What would you charge to do three wire upgrade in a car? $200? What about a battery? Whether you upgrade the battery or if you were to add a second battery? $500? What about alternator?
$500-$600.
Yeah, that's probably
a little on the low side, I think. But
you can get them reround. What about a cap?
Could be.
2 to 3. What's the purpose of a cap?
Flash.
Flash? You in the back. Yep, a cap's there to give the amplifier power when it needs it. Now, think of the way a cap works. It releases energy instantaneously. Then what happens? It has to charge and then release and charge. If we look at a lot of that music we've been listening to, at what point does a cap have time to charge?
Between tracks.
Between tracks. So essentially, Steve's analogy is a really good one. You have this cap, which is like a cup of water, and you have the faucet, which is like your battery or your alternator, and in those tracks, basically, it's just constantly pouring out and constantly pouring in. It's not going to do anything.
So what's the big deal about caps? Why does everyone still ask about caps?
Because they want their lights to stop dimming.
What was that?
They want their lights to stop dimming.
And if you think about what's going on, Jason's done an excellent job of talking about how the electrical system works. Battery's there to start the car, then it has to get fixed by the alternator. So once the car started, don't do this. But technically, you can remove the battery from the system and everything would run off the alternator. Don't do that. It's a bad idea for other reasons. But the energy comes from the alternator. So when you put a big audio system in, like you were saying, like 1,000 watts of power, it starts pulling from that same alternator power source. The battery acts as a reserve tank so that when the alternator is struggling to meet the power demands, typically, a factory battery has a slow discharge rate. It doesn't give up its energy very quickly. So, like Jason had mentioned, don't add batteries. Replace the factory battery with one that'll give up energy faster. The better batteries that you're likely to have in your store, that's a great thing. We have no problem with that because it absolutely does help. But then these guys are putting in caps because the headlights are dimming, meaning that the audio system is pulling so much energy away from that charging system that the headlights are showing a visual effect of that. Back in the day, when I was a younger man, Richard Clark and Dave Navone did a whole thing about capacitors and what they do. And back then, the recordings that we were using for sound quality purposes were high dynamic things like that micro rough track that we started off with earlier, remember? Lots of dynamic information, huge crest factor, large bursts of information followed by quiet passages. So a cap, it's a bottle of lightning is basically what it is. And like you said, you want to put that as close to the amplifier as possible so that when that demand comes in, it discharges the energy and the amplifier flawlessly reproduces the signal without any sags in the voltage. Audibly, there's no sags, but maybe the headlights dim. So here's the reality. If the headlights are dimming and you want to sell a cap to fix it, why are we putting it on the amp? We should be putting it on the headlights because that's what you're actually having a problem with the music. Like Jason said, the cap is on its side and all the water's flowing out constantly. It's not doing a damn thing for your audio system. Can I tell my story?
Yeah.
All right. All right, so here's the story, and this is very, very true. I was working in the tech department, and I got an email from a customer who said he had been to three different shops because...
Real quick, this kind of, it's a different analogy, but speaks into exactly what you were asking about with the customer and you know.
Oh, okay, yes, good point. So he had been to three different shops because he was having, the headlights were dimming, and he was upset he wanted to make it fix, and he got three different stories from the three different shops. One shop wanted to sell him another battery. Another shop wanted to sell him another alternator, a bigger alternator, and the other shop wanted to sell him a cap. He says, I'm confused, I don't know what to do. All right, so here we go. And I went ahead and I had my school sound handout next to me and I laid it all out. I spelled it all out. I said, okay, here's the deal. The battery starts the car, after that it's a load. If you add another load, there's actually less energy for your audio system, probably not the best thing. What you want is a better battery, so consider that. I talked about the alternator, that once the car started, that is the only source of real energy in your vehicle. So if you can get a bigger one with more energy, that would be a really good thing and you're less likely to have the headlights dimming. I said, there's something you haven't mentioned, and that's upgrading three major wires. And I talked about the three wires, and we could talk about other things in a minute. I didn't tell him this, though. But I told him about the three wires and how important it is to make sure that the energy from the alternator is getting to the battery and the rest of the system, make sure the wires are good. I said, as for a cap, what a cap is good for is sudden bursts of information, and unfortunately, most music doesn't have that. So of all the things that you're considering, the cap is going to be the least effective at actually doing anything for you, unless maybe you put it on the headlights. Took him a few days to come back because it was like a really long email. But after a couple of days he came back and said, Steve, thank you. That's a lot of information. I really appreciate you taking the time. I went ahead and bought the cap. I'm reading this email. I'm like, I can't believe this guy bought the cap. And that's when it hit me. If you tell them what to expect and you tell them to expect nothing and they still spend the money, you've met or exceeded expectations. Why did he buy the cap? He wanted it. It looked cool. It might have been a cheaper option, maybe not as cheap as upgrading the three wires, and that actually would have helped them. But he went into a shop knowing full well from someone that had nothing to gain in it that he would get nothing in terms of performance. But he did it anyway. So if you're honest with your customer, believe it or not, they'll just give you money if they want it bad enough. I think you know that this can actually happen. If you say, look, it's not going to help your audio system. It might help the lights from dimming a little bit. Great, they give you $250, $300 for you to put it in, and it does very little or nothing. That's exactly what you told them it would do. However, if you promised them the world and said this, the answer to all your problems are in this little bottle here. If you sell them a bill of goods that it's going to fix everything, and you put it in and it doesn't, you have not met or exceeded expectations. You have not given them confidence that they're buying from a person that knows what they're doing. Everything that we spoke about yesterday that started this conversation is not being fulfilled. That's not the way we should sell. Speak honestly to our customers, even if it's not what they really want to hear, because in the end, you look good. There's one other aspect of the wiring that we should probably talk about. You want to do that?
Sure.
You want to do it? You want me to do it?
You tell them.
Fine, I'll do it. So there's one wire that we didn't draw on the board. We got the ground for the alternator, ground for the battery, wire connecting the two. Then we got a primary wire with a fuse that goes to the back, split out to two amplifiers, and then we go ground to the chassis. What's missing? What?
Speaker wire.
Yes, we are missing that. But there's a wire that's implied. The chassis ground is implied as if it's a wire. Remember, for electricity to flow, you need a complete circuit. And we don't actually show a complete circuit because we're using a chassis ground as our return path. Why do we use the chassis ground as a return path? Don't think about audio. Think about the rest of the electrical system. Tail lights, things like that. Think of the manufacturing when cars first started being made. Wire was and remains expensive. Wire was and remains heavy. So when they were manufacturing vehicles, they were running a wire to the light, and then another wire back, and then a wire to the other light, and another wire back. And somebody said, what the hell are we doing? What's wire made of, in general? Metal. And what is the car made of? Well, why don't we just use the metal of the car as a return path so we don't have to keep running all these wires back and forth? And for low current situations, it's not a problem. But when we start adding things to the system, like a large audio system, something that can draw 100 amps of current or something like what Jason was putting on the board, suddenly that wire, that chassis of the vehicle, may become ineffective. What our engineers in Phoenix had done a couple of years ago is they created a rig and a testing system where they could test the chassis of several different vehicles to determine how much metal is being used as a return path. So we see all this metal that the car is made of, and we say, wow, all that metal, the electricity can use all of it. But electricity doesn't use all of it. It uses the path of least resistance. So what they did was they ran 100 amps of current through the chassis of a vehicle from one point to the other, and they used a current sniffing device to find how wide of a channel of metal it was actually using. By figuring out how wide and how thick the metal is, we could calculate the wire gauge equivalent. I'll tell you this, for a 100 amp draw, it uses the equivalent of about a 4-gauge wire. So if you're running a 1-aught or a 2-gauge from front to back, that red primary wire, your return path is your high resistance return. So when our guys in tech or the guys over at Alpine or Rockford tell you, you need to check your ground, you guys get really pissed off and say, I checked my ground, I made a really great connection to the chassis ground. The problem isn't necessarily your ground. It's that chassis ground because it's ineffective for high current situations. So I have a solution for you, but hear me out, because if you don't focus in on the details, something bad may happen. What I'm going to suggest is, if you're running anything larger than a 4-gauge as your primary to get to the back of the system, where that ground is in the back, keep it there. Add to it another wire connected at that point and run it up to where the alternator or battery is grounded in the front. What you're doing is putting another wire in parallel with the chassis ground. And if you use the same size wire as your primary, you actually have a better return than you have feed, which is a wonderful situation.
What we learned yesterday is when you put two resistors in parallel, does the resistance go up or down? Down. And essentially what Steve's telling you is you have the chassis, which is a resistor, and now you're adding another resistor, so you're going to lower the resistance of the ground, making it more effective for a high current situation.
But please note, I am not telling you to lift the ground from the back and run it all the way back up to the front, because then you get this gigantic antenna that makes a hell of a lot of noise and very unhappy customers and really upset installers. I'm telling you to augment the ground plane. I see you have a question. One more thing and I'll get to you. We also found out that a lot of different vehicles have a really, really bad chassis ground, like Corvettes. It's a split body and it actually doesn't have a very good return path at all. Have you had trouble with amplifiers in certain Corvettes where they just keep shutting off? It's a voltage problem. It's not your primary that's the problem because you made a really good connection there. The electrons have no way of getting back. They're fighting through and the voltage drops due to the high resistance. We also learned that Ford came out with that material that they call quiet steel. You know what quiet steel is, right? It's steel that has infused into it deadening material, something like a dynamat or a hush mat or whatever product you're selling. It's basically built into the steel itself. What are these products made out of? Rubber and heavy things like that that do not conduct electricity. So when you put that into the return path, you have a high resistance return. In that case, what I'm suggesting that you consider doing will make a big difference in performance and reliability. But do not lift the ground in the back, please.
You got a car with a voltage situation, just, all you have to do is run a zero gauge, tie it into the battery, tie it into your ground and back outside the vehicle. If the thing quits shutting down, you fix the problem. Now you just got to run it. Question?
Yeah, the testing that they're doing, is that on more newer unibody cars or is that
It was body-on-frame vehicles for the most part, but we did check some of the other ones. The testing was done a number of years ago, and we noticed a trend. we're kind of going out on a limb that it's not getting any better. We're anticipating that it's getting worse. So if we are doing high current systems, we do want to consider that the chassis is probably not going to be sufficient. And like Jason said, a great way of testing is just have a long piece of one out or something that you can put between those two points that really as a test. And if it has improved the situation, you might want to consider selling that wire and installing it.
You can use your meter and actually measure the resistance of the ground by using the long lead, touch the negative of the terminal on the battery, and then touch different points in the back, and just obviously look for the lowest resistance possible. Yes?
If the option is available, more and more cars have to have it in the back, less than a foot, 2 feet from the amplifier. If that option is available, how do you feel about laying the ground?
That's great. But also consider that the battery is not the primary source of power. It's still coming from the alternator. The good news in those vehicles is they've probably already run that augmented ground plane up there. What you just need to do is take a look at what size wire that is, knowing that ultimately your power is coming from the alternator to the back and then going back up there using whatever wires they have. So if those wires you feel are insufficient for whatever current situation you have, you might want to upgrade those as well. But believe it or not, I'm happy that they're putting batteries in the back because they are now starting to see that the chassis is really not a good return path. So the problem, Jason mentioned trying to find the resistance in the vehicle using the probes, touching in the back. The only concern I have about that is most meters do not have enough resolution to really show it. I had done some research in this, and what you're really looking for is a voltage drop, which is very difficult to measure without a very special setup. So I made generalizations, and the generalization I'd like to say is anything above 100 amps, consider an upgrade. What else we got?
Questions on that? So, something like upgrading your three wires and the ground augmentation is probably the best chance of fixing a situation where you're losing voltage. Then you can go to upgrading batteries or alternators. And the whole point is looking at the dollar spent, if you have a customer that's willing to spend these kind of dollars, you can do these other things which are going to be more effective and take those dollars into improving the system, maybe upgrading this components or amplifiers or subwoofers or things like that. But this should be all brought into the conversation up front. If the guy wants it loud and he's looking at a big system, this should all be brought into the sales process up front. Otherwise, this looks like a Band-Aid afterwards and the customer's looking at you to pay for it because you didn't tell him you needed that up front. So if we look at an alternator, I don't have my book. What page is the...
We're on 34, this one?
If you look at page 35, we have some specs on alternators and cars. So what they do is they'll take a car and say, okay, well, we have the lights, we have the instrument cluster, we have this, this, and this, and it adds up to, say, 50 amps, and then the alternator is going to be about a 55 or 60 amp alternator. They don't give us much extra room for our high-powered audio system. So we put some generalizations there. Most of the time, you can go out to the car, pop the hood. If you can find the alternator right on the casing, it's going to tell you what size alternator it is. But we put some generalizations that you can use for four-cylinder cars, six-cylinder, eight-cylinder vehicles, as far as how much current capacity they have in the alternator. And you can keep that in consideration when you're designing your system. So if we look at some system design, someone give me an example of a really big system they did with thousands and thousands of watts.
313 W7s,
3 1001s, 304s. So 3 1001s,
and
how many 304s? 3. That's a lot of power.
So we have 3,900 watts divide by 12.
No one's going to help you out, Jay. You're all on your
own. 325 amps. Now keep in mind, the system doesn't do that when you hit on. It's all dependent on what level volume you have set,
what
type of music you're listening to, but this is the potential that it has. Did you have problems with voltage in it?
Vehicle ground actually issues.
Yeah?
We had leafed up alternator, three of the big amp batteries, isolator, triple zero gauge runs, and we actually had to run a zero gauge from every battery to the frame through the floor in the truck. Three zero gauges to the frame in the front of the truck to get rid of the voltage.
That's
a lot. I was having almost a
whole
drop between the front of the vehicle and the back of the vehicle.
Wow.
That's crazy. That's a lot of work to fix it too.
So we used Ohm's law to figure that out. Something interesting is as you play it louder, voltage drops, if you have a regulated power supply like a slash amp, if this number dropped to 10, what do you know is going to happen here? It's going to go up. And it can go up substantially.
That's the dirty, dark secret of regulated power supplies. There is no free lunch. We saw yesterday the power equation. Power is voltage times current. So if voltage drops and you keep the same amount of power, current has to go up, like Jason's just saying. So if you have a customer that's looking for a high-quality system, regulation is a good thing because the power is consistent and it doesn't fluctuate with battery voltage, but the current draw will go higher. As opposed to an unregulated amplifier, when the voltage drops, the power output from the amplifier also drops with it. But it's great if you're dealing with a situation where current is not easily available. A lot of cars, it's not the case. You know, you don't have the current available. Consider boats. If you're doing a lot of marine installs, we make a regulated version, and we also make the XD as an M-amp, as an unregulated amplifier. And I personally would recommend the unregulated in most applications, because in a boat, when you run out of power and you can't start that boat, it's a bit more precarious than when you're stuck at the mall. So. That's an interesting point. He said he's got a lot of battery power on his boat for reserve. And if you're doing a lot of key-off listening in a car, then everything we said about not adding additional batteries goes out the window. You need as many batteries as you could physically get in there to extend the life, because otherwise you have just one battery. So like you mentioned, in a boat, if you're key-off listening, which is what you're doing when you're out there fishing or partying and having some fun, key off listening is all coming from the battery. So put a lot of extra batteries on there, absolutely. So you have that reserve energy for not only the audio system, but to start the boat up again. But if you are listening with a key on it in the car, the batteries do become a load.
So what you can do for system design, because obviously if you look at most systems, we would say is probably 1,000 watts. And we said divided by 12 is about 83 amps. Some of you may be thinking, well, geez, I can't sell a guy an alternator every single time. What you can do for system design is what we call the 20% factor, meaning that usually you're only using 20% of the amplifier's power. Now, depending on what music you're listening to, and you can increase that. So if we take a look at this customer who's going to put 1,000 watts in their car, whether it's a 500-watt mid-range amp and a 500-watt sub-amp, 1,000 watts of total power, if we times it by 20%, we have 200 watts, and 200 watts divided by 12 is... 16 amps. 16 amps is manageable for a current draw without probably doing any upgrades. So if you have a customer who's not so demanding and you can qualify the type of music they're listening to, you can use this 20% factor and say, okay, this is going to work in the car. If the guy's aggressive, he wants it loud, bump that up to 30, 40, maybe 50%. These are rules of thumb that we came up with, and it goes into more detail in the book. But this is what you should be using when you're going to qualify the customer and develop the system to say, okay, if the guy's really aggressive and he's a 50, 60%er and you come up with higher current draw, all right, now you have to introduce the discussion of batteries and ground augmentation, alternators and things like that, so that it's brought up in the front of the sale. Any questions on that?
14,000
watt system. 14,000 watt system. All right, let's do that. Is this something you guys did?
Oh.
I'd have a trailer to tow the alternator. So 14,000 divided by 12, if we just look at, want to see what the maximum potential is. You want to guess? Over 1,000 amps.
Is that all?
Now granted, if you apply 50% to that, it's 500 amps. So
all the way down there.
All knobs to the right. Certainly. You want an upgraded alternator.
Or two.
Maybe two.
A lot of times people ask about benefits of efficiency, like a Class D amplifier. The reality is Class D amplifier applied to bass is still going to draw a hell of a lot of current. They're really good for full range now as you start seeing more of them. So there's an efficiency factoring that we do on page 36 and onto page 37 that allows you to compensate for efficiency advantages or disadvantages of the different classifications of amplifiers. Again, these are rules of thumb that make some assumptions, but in general, you can really guide yourself towards some really good system choices by doing the math that Jason said and what's detailed further in the book.
And I guarantee you a lot of your competitors aren't doing this quick math. So again, this goes back to something you can offer to the customer. So when the guy comes in and goes, oh, I want 4,000 watts in my car, instead of saying, you know, that's stupid, that's not going to work, you can go through all these processes, use Ohm's law to show them why it's not going to work. if this guy still wants to buy the system, you know, at least you've set the table for what could happen, as opposed to just walking him or selling the system that you already know is going to fail and then having to deal with it later. So let's go back to our original systems we developed yesterday that we said were pretty good, single 12W7, 1200 watt amplifier. So there's a couple things I want to note. We talked about the frequency spectrum and spending a lot of money. You want to make sure you have good power distribution. We know people like bass, but this is not a good power distribution. You have 1200 watts to the lower octaves, and then you only have 400 up front. It's going to be a very unbalanced system. Granted, I know some customers want more bass than that, but for the most part, you're missing out on a lot of things. So we came up with a system that we think sounds a little bit better. I don't have room to write it on here. I'm going to attempt to write it.
Good luck.
All right, so our system that Steve and I came up with was?
Well, originally you had the 12W7 there. We changed that to two 10W3s. These are midline woofers. They cost about $240 each. We powered it up with an HD750, so a slightly smaller amplifier. Instead of 1200, 750 watts. That sells for $700, Jay. We use an HD600/4, which is an $800 four-channel 600-watt amp. We used the C5, one of our higher-level components, 650s. Those sell for $500 for the pair. And C3 650s in the back, those are $400. I think you had that already. And we used the same power kit, the 2-gauge, 2-amp kit at $250. Everybody in the back can see that clearly, right?
And what was the total?
The total on that system was $3,130, give or take.
So we're $200 cheaper. Better power distribution. We got 750 watts to the sub, 600 watts to the mids and highs. We've actually upgraded the guy because instead of using XD, now we're using the HD up front. So we're going to have a better quality amplifier. We've upgraded the front speakers to C5. So again, a better sounding system. So, and we're a little bit cheaper. What's going to be louder? Well, we can do the other math that I showed you. I'm getting all over the place here, but 3.14 times 6 times 6. What was our cone area?
About 113.
3.14 times 6 times 6 is 113 square inches. And if we do 3.14 times 5.
What Jason's doing is he's calculating out the surface area of the woofers. And a 12-inch woofer typically has about 113 square inches. And a 10-inch woofer has, how much did you come up with?
157 for the pair.
For the pair, so it's about 75 and change for each one.
So this system will play louder. Yeah, I know it's a W7, there's efficiencies and whatnot, but given the amount of power and whatnot, this system's going to play louder with more cone area. We have less power going to the speakers, so we're not really pushing them to their limits. So you got better power distribution. So it's going to play louder, it's going to sound better. This is the more reliable system. Now, in terms of airspace, you're not, you know, giving up more airspace because two 10W3s in a sealed box fit in the same size airspace as a single 12W7. If you port this woofer to get it louder, you can port these and it'll still play louder and you're still in about the same type of airspace. What about current draw? Okay, 1200 and 400, we got 1600 watts. I'm going to times it by 20% divided by 12. So on average, this system's going to pull 26 amps, which that might get us into trouble where we may need to upgrade batteries or I don't mean add batteries, but upgrade the factory battery or add some things. If we look at this system, 750 watts plus 600, I'm going to times it by the 20% and then divide by 12, it's about 22 amps. So a little bit less current, it's going to be more reliable, it's going to play louder. This is actually the better system, and we have a little bit of money left over maybe to do some of those wire upgrades we did. You guys kind of see where we did this? And again, this was done in theory of matching power to speakers, which is what a lot of people do these days. But when you start to factor in the effects of music and some of that other stuff, this can become a very unreliable system, and you have an unhappy customer, whereas this might be that better solution. So let's look at our other system.
This is the lower price of the two from yesterday, if you remember. We had a 13-inch sub, a 1,000-watt amp, a 360-watt four-channel, two sets of components, and a kit.
All right, so what was our system?
We came up with an alternate system of three 10W1s, three 10-inch subwoofers, each one at $140.
All right.
We went to an XD600/1, 600-watt monoblock amplifier driving it. An XD400/4, the 400-watt 4-channel.
What were the prices of the amps?
Each one of these are $400.
All right.
Front speakers, we used a C2650s, a set of component speakers. And then in the back with a coaxial version, C2650X. The components are 250, the coaxials are 180.
All right.
And then the power kit's the same, the 4-2 at $150.
And what was our total?
System price is $1,660.
All right, so we've gone from a single 13W3 to 310W1s, an XD601, XD404, and stuck with the same speakers except coaxes in the rear, saved us a little bit of money in the amp kit. We're $10 cheaper. Which system's going to play louder? Well, we'll do the math on the cone area of the 13. So 143 square inches. Now we'll do the 10s. $235. Big difference in corner. This system's going to play a lot louder. And we did bring the 8-ohm versions back, so we can do that.
Still getting 12?
No. Not sure if we brought the 12 8-ohms back or not. Can't remember. So we got better power distribution. We have better amplifiers. XD is a much better sounding amplifier than JX. So we've upgraded the guy's amps. He's going to play louder. Enclosure space is the same, sealed or ported. So we're not giving up any more space. And we got a much better sounding system. Now if we look at the current draw, we have 1360 as far as total power. I'm going to multiply by 20 divided by 12. 22 amps. And again, that's average, not peak. Now if we look at this system, we got 1,000 watts times 20 divided by 12, 16. So here we have a system that plays louder, sounds better, plays a lot louder, and draws a lot less current. Much more reliable system. Questions?
I have a couple of tweaks to that last system, because I think that, you know, the first system's fun because it's all high-end stuff and we can have kind of a field day because the budget obviously is really not a major issue. When you start dealing with something like this system two and the alternate one that we came up with, sometimes it comes to an issue of a couple of $100 here or there can make or break the deal. The first thing I always get rid of in a system like that are the rear speakers. In my opinion, I want to spend as much money on my front speakers as possible. So if, as an improvement to this system, instead of selling, you know, in this case, the two level, you know, the C2, I might put the C3s up front and say, the hell with the rear speakers. And the logic here is, where does your customer sit? In the front of the vehicle. They're the driver, they're the one paying you. You want to give them the most pleasing experience that's possible. So by upgrading some of the speakers that are closer to them, you can gain that benefit. A lot of times people are asking for a rear speaker simply because they had openings in the rear to begin with. What I would strongly encourage, especially if you're fighting for money and getting the balance of the system like Jason's been talking about, you know, to be where it's supposed to be, I would try to talk them out of rear speakers and get better front speakers, because overall the experience will be more pleasing. And additionally, if the customer comes back and says, wow, this sounds great, I want to upgrade, what do you sell them? Some rear speakers. It's an easy upgrade path, and of course it's going to add to the system overall. It's going to make it louder. It's going to be more pleasing for the rest of the people in the vehicle. In my odd little brain of mine, when I think about retail, I think of every customer that comes in my store, I know exactly what I want to sell them in their vehicle. And in the JL Audio product line, I'm looking at a W3 subwoofer, like a 10W3, and a nice sealed or ported box, depending on the room, and a 4-channel amplifier where I take the rear two channels and I bridge it to the sub, and a pair of good component speakers up front, you know, maybe like a C5 from our line, kind of the higher end, and the other channels of the 4-channel drive in that, and of course, whatever wiring I need for that. How does that system sound? Even if you don't sell JL, you kind of know where I'm going with this. How does a system like that sound? Sound good. Doesn't matter what vehicle it is. It really doesn't. It really doesn't matter what customer profile. You know it could sound really good. But let's say the customer doesn't have the money for the mid or high level stuff. Take the same exact system, a quality subwoofer in a proper built box with a multi-channel amplifier driving it with decent speakers up front, and scale it to the entry level stuff. How does that sound? Still sounds good. Start with a really good core system and add to it if needed and pull away from it as needed. You made a quip earlier that you can't really fall upstairs. So if you start high, you can always come down. If you start too high, you can scare the hell out of some people. So if it's a really big flight of stairs, maybe you have an issue. So I like to go more towards the upper middle end. Kind of show them like Jason did with his system earlier. Kind of show them what's possible. Check out what you could do. I know it's probably not what you're looking to spend, but that's what's possible with just a little bit more. But let me show you how I can make this system sound really close to that and do it. Meet and exceed those expectations by setting up a core system that sounds really, really good, is reliable like the ones we're sharing with you. Think through the process ahead of time. If you're new to this industry, if you're a new salesperson or installer, when you speak to your customer, knowing some of the things that we've talked about today, knowing that there is no free lunch in a vehicle, you have to understand the interrelations of what we're selling. When a customer comes in and they ask for, you know, 415s in their Civic, what are they asking for? Loud bass. Don't sell him 415s in his Civic. Sell him loud bass in his Civic. There's other ways of doing it, like Jason shared with us. Sell him a system and have the conversation. Look, why do you want 415s? Well, a buddy of mine, he had a Suburban and he had 415s and it was really loud and I liked it. So what you're looking for is something really loud, right? Well, yeah, of course, that's what I'm looking for. Can I do a system in your vehicle that will be really freaking loud? It'll have bass like you've never heard it in your car before. It'll kick ass and it'll come in under budget. Let me do that, and if you're unhappy, I'll take it out. If you're new, that could be a scary statement to make, but I'll tell you this. If you're choosing good quality components, it doesn't have to be ours, it could be whatever brand you support in your store. If you're using quality components, the principles that Jason and I have shared over the past 2 days, and you actually design a system that can meet and exceed those expectations, you can say that with confidence. And if you're nervous, turn to the installer or the other salesperson and ask for some guidance of how to get a system in there that will do that. You know you've got the stuff in the shop. You know you can make it happen. It's just a matter of executing using sound physics and principles of the things that we've talked about, so that when the customer comes back, and to me there's no better feeling than this, when they come in and they spend $1,700 on a system, you get them the keys, you show them the system, you play it for them, and at the end they give you that money and they shake your hand and they say thank you. They say thank you. They're thanking you because they think they got more than what you got. Because you did all four of those things that led to the fifth one of value. You gave them confidence that they bought from the right people. You showed them that you do care about what you're doing and you understand these things. They got quality service from a guy that said, I'm going to blow you away. You met and exceeded expectations, and it's not going to break because you set everything up right. And because of that, they got value enough that they said thank you, which leads back to what we were looking for, business growth and an opportunity to do more things in the future. So you can kind of see how we started off with, you know, how are we going to grow business and how are we going to exceed expectations for customers. We went through a bunch of different things like Ohm's Law, and you kind of have to go through the basics before you get into things like Crest Factor, which calls upon all of that information. Crest Factor helps us understand the impact of the charging system, the speaker power handling, and how this all comes into play when we design systems. The School of Sound was put together as a way of helping educate our industry and get back to the basics that I think a lot of us, I know I have forgotten a lot of this as time has gone on. So this kind of helps elevate our game a little bit. Specialty retail is where it's at in this business, and we're really thankful that you guys came out today.